he could, yeah, I don't know how to say it. You could tell he was smart. He like was, you know, he knew a lot of stuff. And I liked him, but we had different beliefs about what meth is. So in the course that we were actually together for some bizarre reason, which we all had 2 mornings in a row. So the first morning he said to me, so math is skills. And I said, no, it isn't. Math is ideas. And he said, no, it isn't. Math is skills. So we had this little banter about skills and ideas. And like by day two, he already said, well, maybe. So the deal is, you have to, so what my focus is today is that most of the teachers in our school system and most of the parents in our school system believe that math is a set of skills. And teachers, whatever they're doing, whether they're teaching three-part lessons or not, in their hearts, they still see math as a set of skills that kids need to have. So I'm going to propose today that math is a set of connected ideas, and we'll take it from there. It seems to me that if we center student learning around those big ideas, it's valuable because it connects things. And when you connect things, you remember things, you put things in perspective better, so it's like all around good. It's management for the teacher. There aren't that many things to teach. There's only this many ideas. And it's also useful for the kids because they can see, oh yeah, like that's just like that, and that's just like that, and that's just like that. So today we will explore what some of the big ideas in number are. So one of the things I'll tell you is I do get the opportunity, I'm fortunate, to like share what I think, and I write books and whatever. And I will write a book in a certain year and I'll say stuff. And like if you ask me 3 years later, I won't have changed like everything, but I certainly will have changed details. So if you read a book that I wrote about big ideas, would I say it the same way today as I said in whatever year I wrote it? The answer is no. For some of them. For some of them I would, and for some of them I wouldn't. But there are some pretty big umbrella things. And the umbrella things aren't changing. It's just sort of like the way you frame it that changes for me. So one of the things that I discovered, and it's funny because somebody asked me about Prime today. I wrote a program called Prime a long time ago. At least it feels like a long time to me. And at that point in time is when sort of the big ideas emerged for me. And when I did Prime, like I was naive and younger, and thought, well, people will get it, like they can do that. And then, of course, some could, but like lots couldn't. And then you realize, but they need to see better, like how to bring it to a closer place to what they're actually doing. Like, how do you move from that big idea to what I'm going to teach today? So I'm in the middle of writing other materials right now, and this is where I'm at in my head right now. I've decided the big ideas are in the background. What I need for you in the foreground are two things. One are, these are the essential understandings that underlie the strand throughout the grades. So there are a certain number of essential understandings in whole numbers or in fractions or in decimals, and you'll see some of them today. And then so in every single topic I'm working on now, I'm writing what I believe the essential understandings are for that topic. A topic is only like 4 or 5 lessons or 3 or something. And then inside that essential understandings for each lesson, I have a learning goal that derives from the essential understanding. So it's like, here are big ideas, then come like particularize it a little bit more to get essential understandings, and particularize it more to say, this is it today. So we're gonna do that today, go from some big ideas to essential understandings to learning goals, just so you can see what it looks like. So at this point in my life, at this juncture in time, I would say this is the piece that teachers need to work on. And if you don't know what you're trying to achieve in a particular lesson, other than they can multiply these numbers, that's not good enough, because that's a skill thing. I want you to have an idea thing that you want kids to walk away with. And so that's how I'm playing it. So I'm doing it my way for what I'm writing, but everybody could do it their own way. They just need that bigger picture. One of the things I'll talk about today is the consolidation of the lesson, whether it's 3-part or 8-part. The consolidation of the lesson is where you bring it to the forefront. So you taught a lesson to make ideas happen for kids. Somewhere in that lesson, you better be talking about those ideas. I think the place is in the consolidation. After kids have like messed around thinking about those ideas, then you want to talk about. So one of the things I'll say today, and again, like we only have a few hours, so it's going to be obviously short.
But we can bring her back.
What I think is huge is that in the last 4, 5, 6, 7 years in Ontario, what consolidation is, it's been a problem for teachers, like it is confusing what it is. And for a bunch of teachers, it has turned out to be sharing the work. And I'm gonna say out loud to you, I don't think consolidation is sharing the work. I think consolidation is using the work, which can be shared in order to bring out the ideas. The consolidation is to bring out the ideas. Like, how do you make them see it? So some people use the word highlight, and that's a fine word, or you can say it different ways. But kids need to walk out of the room completely knowing, oh, that's what we were talking about. Do you understand a whole lot of kids right now walk out of the math room, like totally unsure about what they know about or learned about, except that it was about like tennis rackets or whatever it was about. So if you ask a kid what happened, they might tell you what was the problem about some context, or they might tell you that Sarah and Ian shared and I didn't get a chance. But they won't be talking about what the idea was because nobody's telling them or making them think about, not telling them, making them think about what the idea is. So when I use the word consolidation today, it's only going to be a partial thing, but what you're going to see is these are the questions I'm going to ask to make the learning goal very. So that's our game. So here we go. Ready? All right, any questions before I start? All right, you'll be talking in just a minute. This is a lot of me. All right, here we go. This is a big idea I said a bunch of years ago. I'm still believing on this one. Every number can be represented in many ways, and the ministry tells you that already. This is the part they don't tell you. Each may highlight something different about the number. That's the part I actually care about. So if we say to a kid, you can show 10 as 6 plus 4 or 7 plus 3 or blah, 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 and we all make kids do it, like every teacher I've ever met makes kids do that. Like, why are we doing it? Like, if you don't know why you're doing it, and if the kids don't know why they're doing it, I think you're missing a giant piece. So I think the reason we're doing it is different representations are useful in different situations. Like, I want kids, the lesson isn't show me ways to make 10. The lesson is which ways to make 10 are useful when. You follow that? So that is a different learning goal. So the first learning goal is a skill goal, and the second learning goal is an idea goal. So I'm huge on this one. Like right now, if you said to me what's wrong in Ontario, like to me, this is it, that you're not teaching ideas. So here's an example. All right, so here's my big idea. So it will lead to me to what I'm going to call essential understandings. Remember, you can have all these slides. You can write anything you want, but you will get them. So it could be that if I'm doing a fraction unit, my idea is every fraction can be represented. If you're doing a whole number unit, it's every whole number. Like, it's not really different. But I will show you one that's slightly different. Every terminating decimal, so that's a fancy word. Terminating decimal means it doesn't repeat. Like, it stops. Like, 0.12 or 0.345. Every terminating decimal can be thought of as a whole number of tenths or hundreds or thousands, if you only go to thousands. So here's what I mean. 0.345 is a whole number of thousands, 345 of them. And that's hugely important because that's the way we're going to explain operations. The reason 12 hundredths and 14 hundredths is 26 hundredths is not because you line up decimal points. Is because 14 of something and 12 of something is that many of something, like period. So it's thinking of it as a whole number of some unit that matters. How sometimes my essential understanding is like super close to the big idea, and then other times I veer off of it. And I'm just gonna say one, like that's me in 2016. Right, you know, like in 2017, like I haven't really changed big, but I definitely have changed like little. But this to me right now, this is like big. Okay with that? So based on that, I'm gonna have a lesson in front of me today with a bunch of kids. And so I'm gonna have a learning goal. And my learning goal could be, I can represent any whole number of thousands, this is the whole number at the end, as a whole number of hundreds or tens. So that means if I have the number 2000, it is also 20 hundredths, it is also 200 tenths. So 2000 is also 20 hundredths and 200. So my learning goal today wasn't you can represent numbers in multiple ways. Because if that's my learning goal, it doesn't direct me to what to teach. So your teachers, probably you too, are always seeking direction. Like somebody just like, please tell me what to do. So I'm just like telling you what to do. I think what to do is not just to say I'm representing things a lot of ways, it's like think hard about what you want. I want a kid to know any number that's thousands is secretly also hundreds and also tens. And any number that isn't thousands is not secretly hundreds and tens. Do you follow what I'm saying? So 2004 is not a whole number of hundreds, it's not a whole number of tens, but 2000 automatically is. So that's my learning goal. So whether I post it or not in the beginning varies. So on this one, I'm not posting it at the beginning because I just gave away the whole lesson. Is everybody okay with that? So like sometimes I have learning goals I do post and sometimes I have a note post and this is like a note post because this is a conclusion you have to draw. So this is a, we'll hold it off until the end of the class. And then I'll probably say to the guys, what do you think my learning goal was today after we've done everything? And if they have no clue, you failed. So this is one example of this. Here we go. Here is my main problem. So this is like the action part, the middle part of the lesson. There's boxes of markers. We'll call them a box. There are packages, like 10 boxes fit in a package. You okay with that? Like my artistic skills are like so. And then crates hold 10 packages. Is everybody cool with what that looks like? So there's crates and packages and boxes. And you have to probably post this. The kids keep remembering crates are the big guys and then the packages. Do you understand where I'm going in terms of thousands? Like it's gonna happen. Here we go. I'm gonna say to kids, choose a number of crates. So this is my DI piece. It's a super easy DI. Like I don't have to tell you to choose four crates. And do you get that if everybody in the room chooses four crates, in the end, all will know. Is it 4,000 happens to be 400, which happens to be 40 times. But we won't know it applies to any other situation. We won't know. But I said general matter, general matters. So I'm hoping you pick two and you pick four, and you pick seven, you pick eight, and it works for everybody. Ooh, like maybe this is bigger. So when teachers have everybody use the same numbers, you are definitely leading to no generalization. Or you're leading to bad generalization, like you generalize from one example. That's like worse. So I want often, you choose and you choose and you choose, and the same thing happens for all of us. Ooh, so this is like a bigger deal. You all okay with this? So it's not even hard to say it, it's just like choose. So choose a number of crates. How many packages would there be in your crates? How many boxes would there be? How many markers would there be? Pick a different number, do it one more time. So does everybody do it? All right, just write this down so you have it in front of you. 10 in a box, 10 boxes in a package, 10 packages in a crate. Just in case you can't remember, I just have it for you. All right, at your table, work in a team. Choose a number of crates. Tell me how many packages, how many boxes, how many markers. Do it one more time, go.
Seven boxes.
Package has 10 boxes.
That's what I got.
Which should be posted?
Second. First time I missed one of the levels.
So it goes packages, boxes, markers.
Yeah, I missed one. I only had three. I couldn't figure out why I got the 800 when I was looking for those.
So 7,000 great. No. 700 packages, 70 boxes.
I don't know.
It's 70 packages. 700 copies and 7,000 markers. So one goes this way, one goes this way, and I did first.
Yeah, it's just
the
a
same as yesterday, is that
place value goes yeah, left or right depending on how you want to package it. If you're unpackaging it, you're going to get 7,000. If you're repackaging it, you would go down to the 700. What's neat though is using the picking your numbers and then you have that sample around the room.
Yeah.
We all did seven?
No. The microphone?
Oh.
So it's being
broadcast.
Just so we
bleep, bleep, bleep,
bleep. Yeah. I'm okay with getting mixed up and Scott sorting you.
Trying, isn't it? But it's neat because then you can see the relationship, right? Yeah. So pick four now.
And you everybody's look at the doing something different and thinking something different. You don't have everybody can always do what number they like.
Everything in math is about that. Everything in life is about that.
And beyond that, like I like the fact that they're, you know, I imagine where she's going with this is that now you can say that seven crates, so 7,000 is 70 packages or 70 100s.
Yeah. I use that on the flip chart. You start to cover up. So you show them you have 7,000 and then it's 700, 710.
Right.
They can see that it's the same value. It's
they also start to quantify
work,
these
right?
numbers too. So they start thinking.
All right, you guys in a pretty good spot. We're going to go fast. All right, so here's where you have to make decisions, and there is no right decision. It's just a decision. You could decide right now to actually call on a couple of people to stand up and share their thinking, and like there's nothing wrong with that. And when they share their thinking, you could hear like everything, or you could just like go for just some stuff. So you could decide now. I don't need to hear everything. I just need to ask them. So somebody tell me, it said, what did you notice? So somebody tell me like what you noticed. Could be the only thing you want them to talk about. It doesn't have to be first I and then I and then I. It could be that, but it doesn't have to be that. All it has to be is, so tell me something you've noticed. Is everybody okay with that? You can bring people to the front or they could like stay where they are. There's no right and wrong ways. I don't think of doing this. There's always advantages, pros and cons and whatever it is. The reason I might just go for what do you notice is because that's all I care about anyway in this lesson. That's the whole point. So do I need to hear everything? And the truth is when they tell me what they notice, I'm going to hear everything anyway. You all know that, right? So it's going to happen anyway. All right. So I'm going to pick a group and I'm going to say, so somebody in this group, you be the spokesperson and tell us what you notice. So group over here, somebody tell us something you noticed. This is so cute. This is just like this.
We noticed that the numbers were increasing as you went from crates to markers.
Beautiful. She said she noticed, Kathleen noticed that the numbers increased when you went from crates to boxes. Did everybody notice an increase or was that just them? Everybody. Okay. But how many crates did you start with?
The first
time?
Five was five.
And how many crates did somebody else start with? Not five. Did anybody start with not five?
Three
and seven. And you noticed like the same thing? Like, ooh, okay. So that so you play all this like out. All right. So all she's gotten me so far is that when you went from crates to boxes, it increased. And then you could either hassle her some more or go to somebody else and say, like, tell me, did anybody notice anything else? And eventually you want somebody to tell you notice you got even more, like when you got down to markers. Is everybody good with that? So your purpose is to probably for me. I wouldn't do a credit test I just did with you, but probably for me, that's all the sharing I need, because then I'm going to go for my consolidation question. So I'm just telling you this. This is like a sidebar. My consolidation will focus on why didn't it matter how many crates you chose? You all saw the same thing happen, like it just didn't matter. Why could you always tell how many packages, boxes, and marker? Like nobody said, well, I can't tell you. Only told me crates. How am I supposed to be able to tell? Like you want all the kids to know, always going to work. So that's where I'm going to go with my questions. So here are some, which number was greatest and why? So do you get, if you look at your crate number, your package number, your box number, your marker number, which number was the biggest?
the market for like every single time. So how come that happened? Like, so we'll talk about this. Oh, I have to think about, Yeah, okay, so I didn't, all right, this is what I was saying, all right. So I'm gonna actually ask you, I wouldn't say it to kids the way I'm saying it to you here, but something like, so you said you picked three and you said you picked five and you still like were able to do it. And I'm gonna say, how come they were able to do it like no matter what number they picked? Like, what do you think, Sarah? And Sarah's gonna tell me why she thinks like it just didn't matter which number you picked. So if I ask this of Sarah, Sarah is a mythical person in this room. Do you get that I can't just say it to Sarah because you need thinking time on this one? So inside my consolidation, I'm totally cool to have turn and talk time. So here's a question, guys. I want you to think about it. How come it just didn't matter? So let's try that. Turn and talk for like a minute. Why didn't it matter? Like you tried at least two. How come it didn't matter? Did you do anything different? Did you do the same thing? Why could you do it? So talk to each other.
Because I believe creating things up in a thousand markers.
Sorry?
Because I believe creating things up in a thousand markers.
No, it's a consistent quantity in each package is unit, and there are multiple, or there are groups of 10.
The relationship between each of the sizes stays the same.
Yeah.
So if you change one, you can't change one without the other.
Yeah.
They're all in groups of 10 or equivalent of 10, right?
Yeah. So. But I bet it would work for five, it wouldn't have to be 10.
Yeah, but the math would be harder.
It would be, but
yeah.
I'm just saying,
it would
that
be.
Would be,
yeah.
Might
if you consistently package them the same way,
would that be true for five?
But you would, your math is harder. When you're
right,
not
but just having, I'm not saying I can do it, but I could have that idea.
Oh, absolutely.
Of that.
Yeah,
and that's
if it's
an
consistently
example of what we were talking about yesterday with the engineer. People can think about ideas without actually being calculation.
Yeah. If the pattern's the same, it would work.
But I think that this one,
but maybe not, I'm just saying.
No, it would work.
Yeah, particularly, yeah, but particularly with this one because it's the base 10, it allows you to move from the hundreds to thousands,
right,
and so on. So if you had a had packaging of five and multiples of like, five packages of five and so
it'd
on.
Get messy.
Yeah.
Okay.
It wouldn't have that.
You're always making a judgment. I'm just calling it here. At some point I have to decide, all right, enough. Somebody's ready to talk. And then teachers use whatever skills they have to decide who to talk to. So one of the things that I've been noticing in classrooms, and I'll just say it now, is that I'm actually not going to ask for volunteers. I'm going to point to a table, not a person, a table, and say someone at this table talked. So I already did that with them. And I gave them time to like decide who it was. But what I'm trying to do is to say to kids, like all of you are in, you don't wait for her to raise her hand. Like in a whole lot of classrooms, they just wait for her to raise her hand. So I'm making kids know it's gonna happen. And a teacher has to make her own or his own judgment call about maybe I'm pointing to a person. I'm not doing that now with you because I don't know you. At some point, you know your kids. And you could do that, but essentially kids need to know that each one of them is part of this game. You're not waiting for somebody else to do it for you. And so you have to find whatever ways you have, and it won't be the same for all kids, and it won't be the same for all teachers. But essentially, I think volunteers is not the way to go. Because you always have the same little people volunteering all the time. So they're good, but like nobody else. So I'm just mentioning it because it's part of this game. So at this point, I'm pointing to this table over here, back there. They're avoiding me, but there you are. Somebody at this table, tell us why you think it didn't matter how many crates you chose. Like, it all worked. It just didn't matter. So what were you thinking?
Well, our conversation kind of revolved around the fact that we were always looking at multiples of 10, no matter what table or no matter what number we chose. But then our conversation kind of veered off a little bit because we were talking about it in terms of, well, each time you add a zero, and then we talked about, well, that adding zero doesn't do anything. So how can we kind of frame it in a, or word it in a more mathematical way? So to say each number has one more zero in it, perhaps.
Okay. All right. So she's read some good stuff. So this is pedagogical stuff, so we're back to being teachers for a minute. Saying you're adding a zero is not great language because when you add a zero, you get the number you started with. 5 plus 0 is 5. You taught that to kids. they believed you. Like, don't mess with it. So if I was there on the spot, like, don't mess with it. So you don't want to say plus zero, because do you understand, like, do you understand how this leads to problems for kids?
Yeah.
Because we're not careful. So you have to find other language, which is probably more difficult. So I say stuck on a zero. You said it a different way. What did you say? Put a zero on the end, or whatever word you need. Now, if a kid says add a zero, you're not going to get agitated. You're just going to rephrase it in another way that you kind of want them to hear it. And so you keep rephrasing it this other way, and they'll clue in, and they'll notice that you did it, and that's like all you really need for most kids. Then there'll be some kid who will need you to have a private conversation to deal with this adding zero stuff, but mostly not. So you stuck on an extra zero. So when you stuck on an extra zero, how come your number got bigger when you stuck on a zero? It was 10 times greater. So now you're speaking, and you're completely correct, but you're an adult, and so it sounded like what an adult thing would say, which is totally fine for today. What a kid might say is, well, it used to be four ones, and now it's four tens. Like, that's what I need a kid to get to. Mm-hmm. So essentially, I'm teaching them that the unit changed. A bigger unit leads to a bigger number, but I'm not saying all that stuff. This is what is in my head. That is my goal. So for, and do you understand what it says in the curriculum document, which it does say, demonstrate an understanding of place value. What this actually is that four ones is littler than four tens. And the four tens is bigger because the stuff on the zero helps you see that it's bigger. But you could have said four, T-E-N-S, and that would be okay too, without sticking on the zero. It's still bigger, because it's four bigger units. Are you all cool with that? So you would make a teaching decision. We're not going to play everything all the way through today about how much to pursue this question. You might do more, you might do less. Depends on the kids, depends on a whole lot of stuff. Could you always tell, and you might even check with everybody, did anybody like have trouble like figuring it out? Like you didn't think you had enough information and we could kind of deal with that issue. Then I'm going to say of all the numbers you had, I think we talked about this already, which one was the greatest? So when you look at all the numbers you wrote down for markers, for boxes, for whatever, which was your, just tell us, read us your biggest number. Okay. Table back there. Read us your biggest number. That's all I want to hear.
5,000.
What was your biggest number? 6,000. What was your biggest number? 3,000. Guys, do you notice anything? You know, and then we want to hear, like, we're all saying thousands. Did anybody, like, not say thousands? So why do you think it got to that? Like, that's where I'm going. I'm not going for the problem. I don't actually care about the problem. I'm going for, like, what is it that made it thousands? So then I'll ask questions like, how many crayons fill one package? So remember, there's crayons in a package. How many crayons were in a package? I'll remember, and that's an easy one, and it should be 10. How many were in a crate? How many crayons are in one crate? 1,000. So tell me why it's 1,000. Does that have anything to do with why you said thousands? So we'll chat about all this kind of stuff. Now, here's a different question. So you're going to need a little turn and talk time on this one. So here's my deal. You have some packages. Okay, so remember what packages look like. I'll take it back. Packages, whoops, look like that. You all okay with that? Mm-hmm. There are packages. So you have some packages. What number of packages might you have that fills crates? So a crate is completely full. When you put in packages, what numbers of packages fill crates? So it could be one crate. It could be two crates, it could be eight crates. You're filling crates, they're completely full. How many packages might you have? So this is a turn and talk. We're not going to turn and talk, but it is a turn and talk. Do you understand? It could be 10 packages, which is what a whole whack of kids will say. They'll only say 10 because you said 10 packages fill a crate. And then you're going to have to say, just remember, guys, I said it could be more than one crate. Ooh, and then everybody turns and talks again. And so, like, what other numbers could be? Does everybody get it's going to be 10 or 20 or 30 or 40 or 50 or whatever? Then I'm going to ask, what number might you have that doesn't fill crates? So you have some packages and you just can't fill those bloody crates. There's like space left over. Give me some packages you might have that you just couldn't fill crates.
47.
47. Give me another one. Two. 30. Like, do you get that there's like a whole lot of possible answers? So we'll look at the answers on the board. I will have posted all the ones that you said worked, and then I'll post all the ones that you said didn't work. So, like, what's the difference here, guys? So all the worked ones will be nice multiples of 10, and all the doesn't work ones will not be nice multiples of 10. Are you cool with this? How many tens is 5,000? How is this about? What does this have to do with markers? Why did I ask that? Like, what does that have to do with markers? Then I'm going to send you back to think about that. So I'm going to send you back on this one. If I said to you, how many tens is 5,000? Tell me what in the heck this has to do with markers. I'll ask you in a couple minutes what you think. So talk.
Then they can look at the package. And so they can see how many, not package, many boxes. They can look at the boxes and then they can see how many boxes would be in that 5,000. So that's how it's about. Because each of the boxes represents a 10.
Each of the boxes represents 10
yeah.
markers. Right. Thinking of a package.
So
10 by 1,000 is the idea of how this gives you these numbers. Sometimes I see where they do these numbers without you actually having to quantify it. And so then they get in their mind, they can see by now, what if they were pennies? You know, they can yeah. see that it's still the same amount, but they have the idea. It makes it real for people. Let's talk about people. They can contextualize
yeah.
the numbers are not their own numbers. It blows up. I mean, all of the conversation is straightforward question, and that she did recording all the numbers that work. So
yeah.
I need to do more.
Yes.
But that's
not just
the skill. It's one of the I'm sure you're doing a good job.
Which I'm new to, you just think I'm just sitting here thinking.
All right, so I'm just going to stop you because I am. At the table, talk to us. What were you thinking about as you answered this question? Like, I don't need an answer, but what are you talking about?
We liked how it went from the markers to just so many numbers, and then the kids had to make that connection between the markers and the numbers. And we got to that 10 is really the box, and the 1,000 is really the crate.
Okay. So that was my goal, so that was great. In the U.S., they have these things that are like our processes. They're called standards of practice, and I have to be writing about them now, so it's in my brain. One of their standards of practice is called reasoning abstractly and quantitatively. And what it's about is going from contextual back out to math, back to contextual, like back and forth. So that's what this is trying to do, is the contextual was only there to get you to the math. But then when you got an answer, I needed you to make sense of it in terms of the context. So it's not like I'm living in the context and then out of the context. Like I have to be going back and forth, which is why I asked that question. You okay with that? I could ask you a similar one. I won't do this one with you. How many thousands is 300s, tens? How is this about markers? So it's a very similar kind of questions. Then I could say, and I didn't put it on the slide, but I could have said to you, so tell me, if you knew how many crates, would you know how many markers? Would you know how many boxes? Like that, you could summarize it like that, or that could be your exit slip. Your exit slip for every single kid could be. So if I told you how many crates there were, and I'm actually not going to tell you. I'm just going to say, if I told you how many crates there were, could you tell me how many packages, how many markers, how many whatever boxes, whatever words I used? And that way I'll find out like if it worked. And you could have a second question if you wanted it, was if I said take the number 5,000 and write it as hundreds, could you do it? So you might actually have a contextual kind of exit question and a not. All right. So I'm just going to quickly say something, come back to this slide. I'm just going to tell you, these were the expectations I addressed. Represent, I just whited out the part we weren't doing. Represent whole numbers to 10,000 using a variety of tools. That's what we were doing. Demonstrate an understanding of place value in whole numbers using a variety of tools and strategies. Like, that was what we were doing. But if my head as a teacher is, this is the expectations I'm going to cover, and I write that as my learning goal, it gives me zero guidance as to what to do. That could be like anything. And that's what happens. Like, I don't know what to do. Like, what could it be? And so then you default to which are the hundreds and which are the thousands and which are the tens, because you don't even know, like, you don't have in your head what you're really trying to accomplish, because in honesty, the curriculum expectations are not written to help you know exactly what to do some of the time. So you have to make decisions. And so I'm doing that decision making through using essential understandings and then tightening up into learning goals. Now, having said all that, let's go back to this. I'm going to tell you that I've been told by many teachers I would never think to ask all these questions. I understand. So my question to you is to talk at your table as leaders. Do we need teachers to learn to ask these kinds of questions? Or is that not the best use of our time? Because you have to decide going forward what you're going to spend energy on. And we're going to do lots more of this. So this is cut one. We're going to come back to this question. So this is cut one. Do you think this is something teachers are able to do? Do you think this is something it's worth doing? You are not saying anything to please me today, because I don't really care. You say what you really think. Like, we think that this is the situation. And then we'll come back to the question again later. But I just want you to take a first cut on this, because that's why you're here. You're not here to do this problem. You're here to see, where do I go with my teachers? Does this initially look like a fruitful place? Or is it like this is too much for a teacher to deal with? So talk it over for a little bit of time, and then we'll chat a little.
I'm probably the child that would be on an IEP, because I have more time to process what they say than doing the paperwork.
Are you identifying some challenges that you're
doing? Working it through your mind.
Are you identifying some challenges that we as teachers would have to overcome in order to help to get the things
done? Help me.
Yeah. I'm wondering if that this will, I mean, what we talk about big ideas and areas, teachers don't want to get us the questions. So I'm thinking they need to think differently first before they start. I think it's going to be hard for the course. I think what is an essential understanding? What I need to start with that work first and then the questions, as opposed to the questions. Because you don't know what the questions are, and to have a solid
where you're going.
Big ideas. I don't think it's hard work.
But I think that if we ask, if we start having teachers ask kids these types of questions, as opposed to questions where there's like numeric answers and that type of thing, I think that by teaching teachers to ask questions like this, it will force them to think about those big ideas. You know, like if you have a teacher, or if you instruct, or if you ask teachers to ask one question in every lesson, you know, like that's getting to the root of the knowledge, then I think that that will force them to say, well, what is the root of the knowledge that I want them to have here? What is the root of the understanding that I need them to have? So if you teach, so then it will force them to think about what those big ideas are. Because until our curriculum has a revamping, regardless of what, if regardless of how we present big ideas, teachers are still going to say, but I have to teach this curriculum talk, document. And so I think that if we say, teach them to ask these questions, get to the root of the understanding you want them to have, then they'll start to say, oh, that's what these big ideas are. That's what the root of understanding is.
Maybe. I'm not convinced. But I just hear teachers, they're doing this with their big ideas because the master's and so if you ask them to do this, and it might lead to the big ideas.
Yeah.
I wonder, I'm supporting it's teachers so that they can get in and get some quick payback or something. I don't know. I'm not saying you're wrong. I'm not so it's hard to ask these questions without understanding.
Well, and that's where I like, that's why I just
somebody. I think I'm going to be talking more about this into understanding also.
How do you explore that as a pedagogical framework?
With and this being the goal, okay, let's talk about it. Maybe I don't know.
But I just think that by having teachers, I mean, similarly to what we have with what we do for students, right? We try to present them with stuff and then we say, but they need to come to those conclusions on their own. And I wonder if that's just, you know, like, yeah, we have our curriculum documents and teachers need to, and I know, I think it was Tim who mentioned, you know, like, teachers need to know what the learning trajectory is, you know, like, where things are going. And I think that that's a part that for some definitely younger primary grades might have to be done. But I do think that having teachers come up with to actually zero in on what this big idea was, you know, as opposed to just I met this curriculum expectation.
Absolutely, I'm agreeing with you.
But if we just present them with what the big ideas are, then they're not, you know, like we try not to do that to students. We try not to say, here, this is what you need to know. We try to get them to come to it, right?
Yeah.
So if that's what we can present to teachers, ask a question like this, it's going to get to the root of it, then they're going to come.
Okay, 1 minute, and then we're going to talk.
Or
together.
Yeah.
I think there's a comfort level that teachers aren't, a lot of teachers aren't to design this. They're not actually really comfortable with that math themselves. So when you get a worksheet and it tells you this is how you teach how to do place value, they print off the worksheet and they're comfortable with that.
Yeah.
This takes a lot of confidence to sit there and design and a lot of thought into, you know, a big idea and how are you going to implement it over, you know, over a period of time. And that's why they're relying on, give us the questions. I don't think they're really comfortable designing those questions. So I think there's a lot of PD that can be done just in understanding the math concepts.
Okay, so
not everybody.
I don't feel guilty because you're going to come back to this again. The reason I'm doing this, I'm just going to tell you this because you're leaders and you'll have to deal with this, is that people make decisions and get impressions like instantly. And you have to deal with them now. Like, what impressions are they having now? I need to know what you're thinking because maybe that's going to inform like how I approach things the next time. So it's my experience that human beings like make decisions about stuff like almost instantaneously. Like, so already some of you have said this is good or this is bad. It's clearly too soon for you to make that decision, but I'm going to acknowledge that decisions are made. And then you talk about them because then you need people to hear each other. And you also need to be informed so that you can proceed as well. Is everybody okay with that? So we are going to hit this one again, but I'm just wondering where you're at right now. So a couple of tables, we'll just see where you're at right now. So table back there, Sean's table. So talk to us about your conversation. Anybody at the table?
We talked a bit about, we see the value in this type of questioning. Absolutely. We were all in agreement with that. We think it is also part of our capacity problem that we have. And we talked about your statement that you said maybe we should create an environment where teachers feel like, holy man, maybe I better learn more about this and how you do. And does that come down to principals questioning, asking teachers, what's your learning goal today? I couldn't really tell. I talked to 5 kids, they weren't sure how exactly that comes about.
Cool. Okay. And actually, her last statement was really interesting. I think that would be actually a really interesting conversation to have with to a teacher, like in a very nice way, so that it wasn't really like sure of your learning goal because you had decided not to post it. I'm cool with that. But I wasn't really sure. So like, and some of the kids weren't sure. So that's like a good kind of question to ask. Cool. All right. This table over here, talk to us about some of your conversation.
We were talking about the importance of being able to have those questions at the end and that anticipation. Like, we're wondering, it's one thing to know your expectations, it's another thing to have a rich problem that could connect to those expectations, but do our teachers have the content knowledge to make those connections and ask those questions? So
okay.
What do we do?
So hers is the but that goes with that one, which is a fair but can they figure out those questions? So I've been in ESB 1 a lot this year. I know I'm not getting involved in that. And one of the things that I'll say is that when we co-teach, because we have been doing that, and a whole bunch of teachers will say after it's done, I usually get to do the consolidation, like that's the part they ask me to do. And usually they say, oh, I wouldn't have thought to ask that, oh, I wouldn't have thought to, like she's telling completely the truth. And the only reason I know how to ask it is deep content knowledge. Like, it's the truth. So I kind of know what to do. So this is obviously our dilemma. But then the question begs, but just having deep content knowledge isn't doing it either, because there are people who know lots of math who would still not think of asking these questions. So that's a piece of it. But then you as leaders have to decide, you can't fix everything like fast. Where do we go first? Is it the content knowledge? Is it mixing it with pedagogy? Like that's what your issue always is, right? So if you ignore content knowledge, it's not, you're not going to ever think of these questions to ask, but it isn't just content knowledge. Are you cool with that? And the question is like, what is it exactly? And I don't even care what you call it, but it's more than just content knowledge. And do you get content knowledge just from doing problems? Mm-hmm. Like, I don't know. I'm not positive about it anymore. So do I think you get content knowledge just by taking a calculus course? Like not for teaching elementary school math. Do I think you get content knowledge from a like numeracy course? It could happen. But you still have to be addressing like important. All right. Is there a table who had a different kind of conversation? Okay, good. All right. Yeah, you did. So talk to us.
Table we were thinking about, certainly agree that there's tremendous value in working with our teachers in terms of asking questions. We were talking about how we plan to mobilize that piece.
Yeah.
On the ground level.
I understand. Okay.
And how we do that in a way to spread that outside.
That's
perhaps.
Fair. Okay. So here's going to be the punchline, but I'll tell you now. The punchline. What I'm doing now is deconstructing expectations. So what I'm doing is taking a bunch of words that are written on pieces of paper that people don't know what those words exactly mean, and making you think about like what do those words mean to you, because if you could establish what those words mean, it would get you way closer to what are the ideas I care about and what kinds of questions could I ask and whatever. So you can't do it all at once, and my whole life has been that every time I do anything, I think, well, haven't I told them like enough yet? And then the answer is always like, no. But I have told enough, some people enough for them. Do you get that? But this is called DI for teachers. There are teachers who need like more. Like they need to see it like more in a different way, tighter. Okay. So in the end, every single time I write a book, it is like they needed more. Like here's more. And do you get it? Yeah. And essentially, that's what I'm doing. So when I write, it's really to say, like, if I were writing this class, this is exactly what I would do. Like, that is what I'm writing. But that doesn't mean you should do what I'm doing. It just means, like, this is what I would do. So you can see another model so that then you can decide what you would do. Is everybody cool with that? So I think you already have teachers who just need this idea of maybe working together collaboratively, deconstructing expectations, like what do we really care about anyway? And that's about their beliefs, and it's about what are we going for in a way. And then that's enough for some teachers to do like all the good things. And other teachers, that's not enough for, like they need more because they don't get it yet. And they need, and that's like normal because people are different and different people need more. So I'm going to propose at the end, and I'm telling you now, that I think deconstructing expectations for me is priority one. Like, what are you teaching these guys anyway? You can't just read those words and know what they mean, because you just can't. So you need to be talking to other people to say, like, what do you think they mean? And like, what do you think they mean? And like, what do you think they mean? So that even in a school, you could kind of be on the same page about what you think they mean. So it's been my experience over a whole lot of years, because this is not like new for me, that in any school I've ever gone to, except for like one or two, there are always some amazing teachers doing amazing things. You don't need like any of you to do anything for them. They just like get what to do. But the only time I've ever seen a school change is when leadership changes the school. And leadership means that you decide what you think is your priority and what you're going to be working on. So you're going to have lots of people talking to you, and we'll all have different opinions. My opinion is that if you don't work on what are we trying to teach anyway, you're not doing what you need to do. You can have lovely mindsets, but if you're teaching things that don't matter, so what, in my little opinion. So I need all the good stuff, but I also need you're teaching what you really think matters. Yeah.
Yeah, so this sort of gets to that whole piece about reaching every teacher, every classroom, every student, right? And so if this is a piece that your team decides to delve deeply into, what is it that you need to learn more deeply about right now as a team, so you have the confidence to go back to your system and start to do this work deeply? My worry is always that we do these little piecemeal things, right? And then teams change, network changes, people move away, people retire, and the whole thing fizzles. So as we're sort of working today, if you can really challenge your team to be thinking about what do we need, if this is something that we're valuing as a team and we think could help teachers make sense of the curriculum that we know they're struggling with, then what do we need to learn as a team today and over the course of the next period of time to be able to go back to our system and think deeply? Also think about the math strategy, right? So does this fit in with math leads and principals who have been released for 5 days in a school to do some deep thinking? Can this connect to your team's work? Can you work with the school to deepen your understanding and work with the teachers? You know, what's the impact? So think a little wider as Marian's speaking with us.
All good. Okay. I was going to say something I lost here, but I'll come back. So I think if you didn't know, in my soul, I'm like, except for my family, math is everything in my life. And so for me, I've spent a lot of years deciding what I think. It doesn't make it right, but it's been my set of experiences that has led me to the place that says it doesn't even matter if they do change the curriculum. My guess is they eventually will. Who knows when? My guess is, it's just a guess, it won't change like radically is my guess, but I don't know. But the deal is, it doesn't even matter. If you learn to deconstruct these set of expectations, you can learn to deconstruct any set of expectations. So you need to learn how to get beyond just a bunch of words that you don't know what they mean anyway, and learn how to collaborate on them and decide where is that going to lead us. All right, so we'll put that on hold. We'll come back. All right, here is a different lesson goal that is still about that big idea about representing numbers in different ways, because different representations help you in different ways. So I know some of you are, like, the examples we have will be lots of junior, but not all junior. This one is probably junior. I can change the representation for a fraction to make it easier to compare it to other fractions. Okay, so that could be my learning goal. So my learning goal is not creates equivalent fractions. Did you hear the difference?
Yeah.
So what I'm trying to signal to a kid is it's not my focus that you can do this thing. My focus is that you realize when it makes it easier to compare. So this is what I mean by an idea focus instead of skill focus. But I'm still doing bloody equivalent fractions. Is everybody like, okay. So here is your task. You're going to work on the task at your table. Name fractions. So I have three different things you have to think about. I want a fraction that is just a little more than a half. I want a fraction that's just a little less than 2/3. and I want a fraction that's between 3/5 and 2/3, but closer to 2/3, like that's what I want. So you can do it however you want. You might want to play being a grade 5 student, or you might want to be an adult, like I don't really care. Work on the problem.
So this, I think, goes back to her big idea of every member can be represented in many ways. So this is what it might look like in junior, rather than thousands of this, it's fraction.
There are materials in front of you. You can absolutely use them.
So I wrote 5,000,001 over 10,000,000.
Yeah, nice. I did 51 over 100. I'm junior, so my numbers are smaller.
And a little less than 2/3,
yeah.
I would go with 66 over 100.
Yeah, that worked. I went 59.90.
There's increase in air rods and other manips if you want them here. And between 3/5 and 2/4.
And I would say 66 over 100. Again.
Yeah, I did 65.
Why? You did what?
65 over 100.
Which one are you doing the last one?
What did you do in your mind to go between these two?
What I did in my mind is I was like 2/3 is 0.66666.
Yeah. You doing decimal or percent?
I went 0.66.
Yeah, I said percent.
And so then I was like, so yeah, and I thought was 0.6, so it would be.
I'm more comfortable in percent in my mind than I am with decimal for whatever reason.
Right.
Can you say that again?
Okay, so I know that 2/3 is 0.6666 repeated.
Right.
And I know that 3/5 is 0.6.
So do you think you used a common denominator or not?
Yes.
Yeah.
What was it?
100 is really what I did in my brain.
Okay. So if I heard you say that, I would call on you. Because I think half the class wouldn't know you were using a common denominator. All they would know was you used decimals.
Right.
And so I want them to see that you did the same thing everybody else did. You just did it differently.
Right.
So that's what I'd be listening for as I'm walking around.
Right.
My question is this. Okay. So what do you do when you have a student that does that in... Basically, by the time you explain what to do, they're done. And you have a student that doesn't have any concept of what a fraction is.
Well,
and they're both in grade 7. And that's, and I understand different level of entry. And I, but the extreme I find in the classrooms now is so varied.
But it I think that you keep going with it, because then you would look at me and you would say, can you get even closer to 2/3?
Yeah.
And then that would make me have to think, because then I wouldn't be able to use the common denominator of 100. I'd have to come up with a different common denominator, right?
Yeah.
So what I did, because that you guys were asking, in my brain, for even for a little less than 2/3, I converted 2/3 to a decimal. So I know that that's 0.666 repeating. So then a little less. Like in my, this is honestly where I thought about it in my brain. It would be like 66 over 100, but it would be 0.66. Keep going. So I'm like, well, a little less means I don't need to use those. So that's my little less than 2/3. Because 2/3 would be 66.666 over 100. That's where my brain is.
Okay.
Yeah,
a little more than half. Okay. So a little less than 2/3.
So then I knew and then I knew that 3/5 is 0.6. So I know that that's 60 over 100. And so, well, my 66 over 100 still was.
Less than 18. That's your common denominator.
Was my 100.
Right. Right.
Even though I had gone, and again, I mean, this is because I'm comfortable with place value, right? So even though I knew that 3/5 is 0.6, Like I didn't go to 6 over 10, I went to 60 over 100. To know that that was a little bit bigger.
So is that something that
Yeah, that's common in grade 6, sorting, ordering fractions.
Oh, I understand that, but would they have gone to that?
I would have students that would
do that.
That's the hard thing I struggle with. You have 30 kids and you have 4 or 5 of them that would, and you say go closer and they just keep adding zeros and they figure that out instantaneously. So and then you have students that they have no concept of what a fraction is. And that's after you've done fractions and you've worked with them, and they just, and it's hard. That's my biggest struggle teaching, is I end up running 3 different programs in a classroom because it's just so varied. You have kids that can do grade 6 that can easily do grade 9 math, and you have kids that are struggling to do basic.
So this one actually would help, right? So you've got your 2/3 is right here, and you've got your 3/5 is right here. So you need something that ends up in between them, so they could just come up with that.
Yeah, that's right. My strugglers use that all the time. I encourage it. I actually built one that's 3 long, so they can go into improper fractions.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
More than one, so they get that concept that it continues on.
I tried to color this. I just created it actually using a table function on Word, and I tried to color it in order to show some equivalencies and stuff. It was really hard to do, but I think that would be kind of a fun task to have kids, you know. So I tried to color so that like a half was green. So then I tried that this, the 2/4, that part
That's
would be green,
green.
And then that part would be green, cause it, and that one would be green because it all ended up being at exactly a half. And then, but then I went, okay, so then a third was blue or whatever.
Yeah.
And so then I colored that one blue,
okay.
And then I colored like that one blue, and so I tried to go through and color them, and it was an interesting.
Oh, so layers,
it would be a good activity for kids.
It would,
yeah.
and
I just
like, use and
the
just,
ruler. I just tell them.
Yeah, to just line it up.
Yeah,
that's what I was
saying.
I don't. But it was just kind of an interesting when I was going through it. I'm like, how can you do this? And I think it would be kind of fun. Oh, yes. Well, see, I end up with students in high school who can do the operations with the fractions. But they truly have no understanding.
Yeah.
So I end up in grade 11. We have to add and I'll show you. And that's the part that's so weird, right? Because we end up in grade 11 where we're asking kids to do this.
All right, we're going to talk a little bit. I know you're very involved in your fraction problem. Is everybody like through, like you're still working on it, but you sort of have ideas? All right, so what I'm going to tell you is that my consolidation is going to focus on not what the answers are, but why the answers are what they are. I've been around, and this would be a time, I'm just telling you, that I probably would be walking around with my iPad capturing your work, like with manipulatives, and showing it, or however you guys do it, so that kids could see what other kids have done and speak to it. So this would be a place where technology actually is very useful in terms of taking pictures of what's going on for kids looking at. If you ask kids to bring stuff to the front, like that is a disaster. Like, first of all, they're too little, and stuff falls everywhere. It just isn't working, so you need to capture pictures and see what's going on. And all of you approached it in very different ways. So this would be, in honesty, a time where I think sharing is worthwhile, because I think there actually is stuff to share. I think that what teachers keep looking for is like one way that always works, and there isn't such an animal. So I think there's times when a sharing is like a waste of time, But other times I think the sharing is really valuable time because people really did see things in such different ways, and those different ways are actually useful mathematically, and so this would be a time where I might share. So everybody cool with that? So I didn't connect, so I'm not connected, I should have. But you guys are big, so you can talk a little. In terms of actually doing, we'll do the little more than a half, the little less than two thirds, and the third one separately, even though some of you did it all in one, like that's cool too. So here's what my consolidation questions will focus on, is what strategies did you use to name the fractions? So somebody talked to us about, I did a little more than a half, like what did you do? So I said I was going to call on Cheryl. All right, so Cheryl, come to us. It's hard.
I know. Should I hold up a visual?
If you can, it's this is why you should have an iPad.
Okay.
Just briefly, first tell them what you started with.
Okay, so I made up, there's my whole. So I broke it into a half and a half. And then I figured out that within this yellow part, there was 5 units. So that would be 5/10. So then I took this rod and I knew it was 1 more than 5/10, so 6/10 is just a little bit more than 1/2.
So in the course of doing what she did, did you actually ever name a fraction a different way in the end than what you started with?
Well, I used tenths opposed to halves.
Okay, so instead of having the 1/2 that you started with, she decided to call it 5/10. And calling it 5/10 helped her because in the end she said, so my answer will be 6/10. So why did she go to 6, guys? Why did she go to 6 times? One more, is that supposed to be more? So I went, I'll probably say, because this is me, could you have gone to like 7 times? Is that still a little bit more? And then we'll have our little debate on that one, because like some kids will go, no way, and other kids will be like, all okay. Is everybody okay with that? All right. Who used a totally different strategy? I didn't do anything with times. Yeah.
We used the
tower.
The fraction strips.
Yeah.
So we just visually looked for which was the closest, but a little bit more. So we actually ended up with the 15ths, 8/15ths.
Okay.
So we did that for all the questions, and then we just verified making.
Okay. All right. So then it becomes my job to ask more questions. So my job is, like, how did you know 8/15 was more?
Because when we looked visually here, that we lined up the lines, it was just a little bit more. So even though the other fractions were more, it was actually the one that was closest.
Okay. All right. And this is an interesting thing. So this is a sidebar. It's because it's on a piece of paper that she could do that. Mm-hmm. Do you get that if there had been real strips and they hadn't been lined up on the left, her strategy fails? Are you okay with that? Mm-hmm. So then a teacher has to make a decision. Do I want to address that? Because otherwise some kids will get misconceptions that could go in bad places. So you might, and this is a decision, put up strips. So there are these magnetic versions of these you can put up. And you don't line them up on the left. And you make it so that the 8/15 is not beyond the half. And I said, but I thought you said 8/15 was more than half. And then you say, so what do you think happened here? Maybe sometimes it's more and sometimes it's less. Like, what do you think? And I want the kids to know, like, you don't think that. Like, that's not a good thing. And so you probably need thinking time to address that. So this is about having content knowledge to know why are kids making errors and preparing for that error. And you can decide that why would you, so here's what some teachers tell me they do. But I would never show them a wrong thing because it'll lead them to a wrong place. And hopefully you know that you have to talk about the wrong thing because they're going to go to that wrong place anyway. So you best be in control of it. Yeah.
So a lot of kids, when if left to their own devices that I've seen, will start trying to draw the circles.
Okay.
Right? And don't think of it in a linear.
Okay. So do you understand that if kids draw circles, the truth is whether they draw circles or rectangles, and trying to decide something a little more than half, that is a disaster waiting to happen. Because they cannot make them equal. They are people. They can't do that. And so they will make wrong conclusions. So one of the questions is, should kids use prefab materials or should they make their own? And I'm going to say it depends on what you're after. So if you're just fooling around with what's a third look like, let them make their own. And you're going to be a little off and you're okay, but if you're a lot off, you deal with it. If you're going to say who's a little more than a half, prefab is essential because they'll be too close. You can't humanly like do it right. So you have to make like conscious decisions about when do you do this and when do you do that or whatever. Now prefab can be Cuisinart rods or counters or whatever, or prefab can be these fraction towers. I'm very fond of the fraction towers, which is why you have them, because I think they show like a lot of stuff all at one time, which is helpful for kids to see. But what they do, because they're prefab, is they do like some of the thinking for you. So a teacher has to like get in there and deal with some of like what could go wrong if it wasn't prefab. Are you okay? Yeah, go ahead.
And I also think it's teachers' comfort level with using manipulative things for different things, because I've encountered a lot of teachers that don't use Cuisinart rods at all,
Okay.
Right? And they say, what do you do with them?
Okay, so here is the hard nose me. The hard nose me says, you don't have a right to decide, I don't know, and I'm not going to use it. You don't have that right. Like, you're in charge of people who are, like, little and depending on you. So you have to, like, bother to learn. And the truth is, learning in 2016 is a ton easier than it was like 10 years ago, because you just go find a YouTube video somewhere that shows you how to do everything. So our excuses are like not as good anymore. Like, you could learn. Now, I'm not saying you have to learn Cuisinart rods, but you could, you have to find like, what are the tools I could use and at least try some out and decide, hey, I like these too. Because one of the processes is called selecting tools and strategies. So that means kids have to be able to select, and that means you better know more than one.
Yeah, and that gets into the non-negotiables that we've been talking about as well, right? That, and again, I think you guys have all heard of the heart surgery, right? You don't want a surgeon that's using practices from 50 years ago operating on your heart today, right? So I think this is one of the non-negotiables. When people say, well, you know, my teachers aren't really willing to use manipulatives or representations or whatever it is. Baloney. Like, why are we accepting that as an excuse? And so how often as leaders are we going into classrooms and looking for these things? Are they being used? Are they out? Do we know as a system that our teachers are comfortable using these, our students are comfortable using them when they need them, that there's lots of variety for kids to choose from? Because if that's not happening, then that's something we need to be thinking about.
So, but working on it, like, we're sounding nasty here, and it doesn't have to come out nasty. It's just like, hey, I saw somebody use Cuisinart rods. Do you want me to show you what they showed me? And you're sharing knowledge. You're not doing it in a, like, I hate you way. You're doing it in, here's a possibility. But it's like in your heart, you're saying, I'm not just going to accept it. You're finding good ways to interact with people to show them that they could do it. And you're going to say, like, I really think, and like, they were convincing me, like, this is really useful. Like, let's try it, see what you think. So I'm not getting into today all of that important stuff about how all of your job is about how do you interact with people to make things happen. And so we can't talk about all of those things today. But you can say, I think this is important enough that we need to make it happen. And then you have to use all of your other skills to bring to bear to make it happen. So some people in this room use Cuisinart rods, some people use the tower. When she used the tower, one of the things I said was I might go to using strips and pull things away to show that her strategy didn't work. I might say something like, well, let's just like look at those numbers. So what if she picked 8/15? If she had picked 8/15, could you have told me it was going to work even without looking at the tower? Like, what do you think, guys? And then I'm going to have guys talk about that a little bit. Do you understand that my end goal is the kids know 8/15 without looking at the tower? So I have to make it apparent by saying it. So what I see happening a lot is we want kids to use materials and people are letting them and they're saying 8/15, but the step that is critical that isn't happening is, would you have known 8/15 would work even if like the tower wasn't in front of you? And there's some kids who will say, no, I wouldn't have, but there are some kids who will know and like they get to talk. And so they get to inform the other kids so that they kind of learn that you really didn't need to know that. Is everybody cool with that? Did anybody use no materials whatsoever? You use Julia, use no materials whatsoever. This is what Julia said. Go talk.
So I looked at 3/5 and I looked at 2/3 and I thought about them both as decimals. So I saw 3/5 was 0.6 and 2/3 was 0.66666. And then in my brain, I was like, okay, I can use those as 60 over 100 and 66.666 over 100. So a little less than 2/3. I just get rid of my 0.66.
Okay. So one of the things, this is not necessarily what a little kid would do. But by grade, we'll all do this. So by grade 7, most kids have chosen decimals are the way, don't do fractions. And if they've made that decision, do you get that the reason they made that decision is that if you use decimals, you have common denominators? When she said 0.6, she was really saying 60 out of 100. And the other one was out of 100. And so like it's automatic, it's done. I don't have to like think it, but I'm really secretly doing that. So you need to bring that out because you want kids to understand that if any of you change a half to 4 A's and ends at 5 A's, you were doing nothing different than Julia. You were just using A's instead of hundreds. In, I'll just tell you this because it's an interesting production story. When I work in the US, the US is the US and they do things their own way. And one of the things they do is, I don't know if you're aware of this, but they do the fraction work much earlier than we do because of their like little inches issues. And so all the kids are adding fractions in grade 4 and 5. Multiplication and division is 5 and 6. Like it's all over. Like our guys don't start till 7. The French in Ontario start at 6. So one of the things that's interesting is they don't use hundredths, they use 60ths. And they do everything in terms of a clock. So a half plus a third means an hour has 60 minutes. So half an hour is 30 minutes. A third of an hour is 20 minutes. Altogether, that's 50 out of 60. The answer is 50 60ths. Now, some of you will get agitated. That isn't, quote, reduced, another bad word. But like, who cares anyway? It's like the right answer. So you always have there are like so many more choices than we're even aware of. And I know that lots of you, I overhear you, were saying that we were all schooled sort of in an old-fashioned way. Indeed we were. Like I'm older than most of you, like me too. And then you decide to learn more to like, but there's like other ways to do it too. And there is almost, I would say probably never, but almost never for sure, a best way. It's like that one works for me. Like, I like that one. Do you understand how if you use 60, if you had sevenths, you would be very unhappy. But when we use thirds, we were not that happy with 100. So if I were adding thirds and fifths, I would use 15ths or 30ths or a totally different number. Like, so do you get there's always choices. So what our teachers are looking for, this is my belief, I could be wrong. But when you talk to teachers, what you're hearing is like, tell me the best way. Like your answer is there isn't one. Like that's the truth. It's like there is no best. This is good for you. This is good for you. This is good for me sometimes, but like not good for me like other times. Like I go with the flow. So what you truly want are kids who like think differently in different situations. Like your ideal math student is not the one who has one way to do everything correctly. Your ideal math student keeps changing on you what they do because they're flexible enough to do that. But that means you need a more ideal math teacher who encourages, like we're not putting up with different strategies for a period of time. It's like, hey, I like that one. Like, I like that one. And your body language is gigantic. Yep.
So what are your thoughts on the most efficient?
I think that's the worst word you could ever use. First of all, by nature, no 10-year-old is efficient. What's with the efficient? You don't ask them to be efficient in any other subject area. Why in the heck is math about being efficient? You want them to like get it, slow or fast. That's the truth. And do you get that if you do stuff a lot of times, you get more efficient with it
find automatically. So I could have a strategy that on the surface looks inefficient to a bystander, but I use it all the time and I get like pretty good with it and I get like efficient with it. People who say the standard algorithm is more efficient are lying because it's only more efficient sometimes. So here's a question, 500 minus 499. 500 minus 499, are you all ready to do that question? The standard algorithm would be stupid. It is not efficient. It is like anything but efficient in that case. But in other cases, it's like super efficient. So like there is no most efficient. Like and teachers have just been railroaded to believe all this stuff and they just like buy in. And so it's part of your job not to like shake them to the core, but to just make them see all of those like done deal rules. Like there aren't that many done deal rules. There's like stuff, 4 and 2, like really a 6, like don't say anything else, but hardly anything else is a done deal, I don't think. Yep.
Karen, can you speak to the practice piece? So you have the,
yep,
essential understandings or enduring understandings that you want your kids to know. Talk to us a little bit about
the practice.
To practice that ongoing throughout the year.
Okay, so it depends what you want to practice. So I want to practice a lot of different things. So one of the things I want to practice is thinking. One of the things I want to practice is problem solving. And one of the things I want to practice is skills. And so the practice looks different in those different situations. So if we associate the word practice with the skill part, I think that's too limited an association to make. So I want teachers to know that if we want to get good at something, we practice it. And it could be like a big important thing to practice, or it could be like a little baby thing to practice. And we probably practice different ways. So if somebody said to me, like, would you ever give a kid a worksheet? I'm actually going to tell you that at my age, the answer is no, like straight out, like no. Would I have kids like answer questions like give me 6 fractions that are a little more than a half, convince me? The answer is yes, but that's practice too. Because how are you going to get those 6 fractions more than a half? Like you are like practicing fraction stuff. So to me, that would be practice I would do. Would I ever say, does a half equal 2/4? Yeah, I probably would, but it would be like limited and it would probably be in a game situation. I'm not saying worksheets are evil. They're not evil. Most of you were probably very successful in worksheets or you wouldn't be teachers. Mm-hmm. I was very successful in worksheets. Here I am. But that doesn't mean it's like the right thing to do. So the reason most kids who are successful on worksheets are happy with them is they love all those check marks. Like you feel good with like all this constant affirmation about how great you are. The kids who don't understand it get absolutely nothing out of a worksheet, like nothing, if they don't already know it. So like, how could that be useful? Like to me, it just isn't. So, but do you need experience practicing things? So like, can you do it occasionally? I guess so. I would rather have kids play a game because it's just like more fun and I like fun. But like, it's not that worksheets are evil, but I don't think that's what practice should mostly look like. If it happens, it should be like little piece. So when I write, so in the materials I'm writing now, I have a piece at the end of the consolidation that's called Your Turn. And in the Your Turn, essentially it is practice, but I equally practice a couple of skill questions, like I never have more than 1 or 2 of those, and then a bunch of bigger idea questions, which are more thinking. So for me, it isn't about necessarily problem, but it is about thinking. So I think it's useful for us to talk about problem-based learning, but I actually think it's more useful to talk about thinking-based learning. So I want kids to think. That doesn't always mean like a problem. It means like think. So if I said to you, like, why would you use a different strategy to decide if 3/4 is more than 2/3 or not than a half and 8/9? That's thinking, but it's not a problem. Do you follow what I'm saying? So I'll say that one again. Here's a half, here's 8/9. I ask you who's more. Here's 3/5, here's 2/3. I ask you who's more. Do you do the same things? Why do you, why don't you? Is everybody cool with that? I think that requires thinking. Like, I don't know about the category thinking. I don't care about that, but you have to think. So I don't need everything to be a problem. I need kids to be thinking most of the time. So my practice, in order to learn to be a thinker, you have to practice thinking. So part of my practice is practice thinking, and part of my practice is practice skills. All right, let's take a break now. Take your 15 minutes, have your coffees, we'll come back.
I set the coffee, it's not up a slide today, it's spread it out, so no line up.
So, thanks for being such great sports.
talk some afterwards. Here is some of the, we're not going to talk about these. Here's some of the other consolidation questions I might ask in that lesson. Why did you, I would have talked about each of the things. Why did you change the name? And it says, why did you? But in reality, I will have to say, like, did you? And why did you? Or I might say, so Sarah didn't change the name, but like Ian did change the name. So like, what do you think? Did Sarah like secretly change the names? Like, what do you guys think? And like, we'll talk about it. Do you understand that whatever strategy you use, you actually had to secretly change the name of the class? Had to. You can only be a little more than a half if you realize go over 4/8 or go over 3/6. Like, you had to. And so that's what, remember, that was my learning goal, so that becomes the focus of my lesson. So I probably, knowing me, we do it exactly the just way I said it. So she did it and he didn't, but I think like secretly she did, like what do you think? And they'll talk about it, whatever. How do you know the names you changed them to were correct? So if I changed the name of a half, let's just say I changed it to 50/38. Do you believe me? And I want them to tell me no. Then I'm going to say I secretly changed a half to 14/38. Now do you believe me? And I still want to know. And I want them to realize the only way I can change a name to for a half is if the top guy is half of the bottom guy. That's what I want. Is everybody cool with that? So I have to find, and what I keep telling teachers, so I'll tell it to you, because this is really important. So in several boards where I'm working now, where I'm going back repeatedly, what we're working on are co-planning and co-teaching lessons. When we're doing it in this particular environment where I'm involved, we have like rules. And our rules are every learning goal is going to be an idea. Like, you can do whatever you want when I'm not here, but like when I'm here, it is. And what's it going to be? And then the idea will be. Your consolidation is planned before we walk in the class, but then we change it depending on what happens. So I need them to know that I don't just like go in hoping for the best. I go in with a plan, but my plan has to be based in reality, and so things happen, and I'm going to change my plan. So I'm going to ask an important question, but I'm probably going to say it a different way than I wrote it on that piece of paper because of something that Elizabeth said. So instead of reading it the way I did, I'm going to say, so Elizabeth said blah, blah, blah. And I'm just going to take what happens and infuse it into my planned questions. So what I believe teachers do now, and I can tell you this is a fact because I get lesson plans from teachers, is they tell me in great detail what the activity is going to be. And then for consolidate, they say, and consolidate. Like, hello, like what's that going to look like is like what we're focused on. So I'm telling you, I suspect the teachers I'm working with are no different than like all sorts of other teachers, that they plan in great detail how they're going to give things out, who's going to be grouped with who, how everything, like who's going to have what materials, and then like they just leave and I'll consolidate. And that's what I think is a big missing piece and worth addressing.
Huh? That's the unknown. That's the evidence of the unknown.
That is the evidence of the unknown. No, it's not the. What it is my assessment of whether they got the ideas that I wanted them to get.
No, I mean, on the part of the teacher sending you a lesson plan.
It could be that. Yes, you're right. So hopefully I will respond.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because
it could be.
I have no idea.
It could be. Yeah. I think Chris is right. It might be, but I'm saying that if they're typical, that would mean like most of them don't know what to ask. And if I'm not reading it, like they still don't know what to ask. So I'm proposing that they have to understand that this is like a critical piece of the lesson plan. And maybe initially you have to do it collaboratively until you get a good feel for like, how do you go? In the end, every man or woman is standing with those kids usually alone. So in the end, you are alone, but you have to like learn how to do it. And you usually learn how to do it with other colleagues, right? So I think the same reason that they all asked me to do the consolidation part of the lesson is the reason that they send me, you're right, lesson plans that don't have any consolidation in them, because they don't know. So this is what I believe, is they don't know what they're going for. So we're back to the consolidation and the learning goal are a package deal.
Yeah.
they go together. So if you don't know your learning goal, you can't do consolidation. You can't do consolidation without having a learning goal. Like, this is a package deal. You have to unpack to say, this is what I care about, and this is how I'm going to find out if I got there or not.
But that's the, I think that's the process that I'm thinking
about. Okay.
I'm thinking about it. I know, working with you directly, yeah, that when you're writing, you're always thinking about what you're going to ask at the end.
Correct.
So you work with that.
In mind, yep.
End in mind,
yep.
Always. So it's the question I think that we need to think about in this leadership,
yes,
piece is, every time we're trying to bring people together, they need to be thinking about the end game. Absolutely. In terms of the learning goal, and worry about what that problem
I
is
fully
as
agree.
A result, yep, of the questions you want to ask. Right?
Yes. And I think that's what I've been trying to say, but Krista said it nicely. Is everybody cool with that? Like, so when I said earlier today, I think this is like the big piece. Like, that's exactly what I'm saying. What am I after? And when you're unpacking expectations because you don't know what you're after, you're just like reading words. And then because you don't know what you're after, you default to like what somebody did with you like 25 years ago.
Where this would be lots of,
yeah,
fun.
Yeah, yeah, yes, absolutely, yeah. So lots of fun. I mean, I do want kids to have fun. And mostly when I'm with kids, they actually do have fun, but it's purposeful fun. And so we don't have enough resources, time, energy, not to be purposeful. So when Krista said with the end in mind, essentially I am doing every single lesson as backwards design. Like, this is what I want kids to walk with. But my walks aren't skills. For me, the skills are happening embedded, like fooling around with games. My learning goals that you're seeing with me now are learning goals that are ideas. And it's not like it's evil to have a skill learning goal sometimes. It's like totally okay. But that's like, to me, a smaller piece. The missing piece is the idea piece. So the kids who end up successful in math are the kids who see connections, not the kids who can do discrete things. So I used to teach at a university, people who wanted to become elementary teachers, these are all intelligent people. And many of them over the years, like I would say thousands, would say someplace I was a good memorizer and then I hit a wall. And the wall happens at different grades or university for different people. But the wall was, they never learned to think. They only learned to do what they were told. So if you don't want kids hitting walls, you have to get past skills. But you have to. And people who feel mathematically okay, like look for relationships, look for connections, whatever. I was in a grade, so I live in Ottawa. There's this lovely teacher in Ottawa. I keep running into her like everything I do. And she's a high school teacher, and she's been asking me like for 2 years like to come to her class one day. And I keep like forgetting or traveling or whatever. And then I like saw her in May and I thought, okay, like do it. So we set a date and went into her room. It was a grade 9 applied, so it's fresh because it was just recent. And she does all kinds of wonderful things. She's a lovely teacher, does all kinds of good things. Her kids are using what they call those vertical non-permanent surfaces. They're doing all kinds of cool problems. They Google Doc everything, like all sorts of great things happen. But what I'm observing when I'm with those kids is that I know they're applied, but they see absolutely no relationships, like everything is brand new. The problems we were doing in that grade 9 class, and those are, I gave her 4 lessons to choose from, and this is the one she chose, were ones I would ask junior kids to do. But all you need is seeing relationships, because like the problem could be, could you write 300 as the sum of 3 consecutive numbers? Like, you could ask that of junior kids, but we were asking grade 9 kids. And, you know, so virtually every problem I had, like virtually everyone, could have been done in junior, could have been done in her 9 applied. And the kids worked hard. They were, like, it was a great environment, and we got places in the end. But what I observed is kids don't look for relationships, because I don't think anybody teaches them to do that. And kids who are very capable, like, figure that out by themselves. But most kids don't figure that out by themselves unless you push. Math is about relationships, like looking for connections. Oh, that's just like that. Or I saw a 6 and a 12. Bells should go off when you see a 6 and a 12. Do you understand? For some kids, bells do not go off when they see a 6 and a 12. So We communicate through kids to kids like what we value in a lot of different ways. So Aswin and I were just having a conversation. So I'll just say it now because it relates to what I just said. And this was about assessment and what is, so do you understand that parents and kids look at what you assess visibly? Like you assess for learning like all the time, like you can't even help it, it happens. But when you do assessment of learning, however you do it, because somebody, like kids know what's happening most of the time, not all the time. Little kids don't know what's happening, but older kids like totally know what's happening. And when they see it happen, they intuit what you care about by what you ask them to do. Like they're not stupid, they get it. So I've been saying, like I told you, you evolved, and so this is my mantra this year. I think I've always lived it, I just didn't say it. I know skills matter. There is a piece of curriculum that's called knowledge. And so I need to know how kids are doing on skills. I actually never do that visibly. I always do that on the sly with checklists that they don't see. The only thing they see me assess for of learning are thinking questions and problems. That says to them, that's what she cares about. Okay, that's what I'll do. Because that's what kids do. Like they react to you. So if your kids see that what you care about is good thinking, they like start doing good thinking as best they can, right? You know, different kids, different amounts, but they all do. If they see you looking for relationships, like how is that? If you saw those numbers, like what would you think? That's where they go. So, I mean, I think you just, teaching is human nature stuff. Like this, people react to what you react. So I have friends who teach high school who have a heck of a time getting kids like to deal with the fact that they aren't assessing like baby little things because that's been like their whole life. So it's not like you don't assess them, but for me, it's like on the sly, like it's happening, they don't have to see it because what they see actually matters. So I would say as a teacher that if I taught a lesson and nothing happened that did, that made a, like if no thinking happened, like I wasted an hour. Like it doesn't have to be think your every single minute of every single day, but your blood, you know, you should be doing thinking. Like that's what the game is. And I think the difficulty we have in the school system is children come to you in different situations. There are kids who've learned that thinking is fun and good because they live in households where that is the message. And there are kids who don't know that at all. They think thinking is like horrible. And like, you know, who would want to like bother thinking? And so like you're it for them. And so you have to work on it and make it attractive. So when I said earlier today about problems that are interesting, I didn't mean interesting like it's about a skateboard. I mean like interesting like learning is interesting. Like I kind of want to know. Okay. And so I think that's what makes it hard work. So anyway, that's, we're off with assessment. Here we go back. All right. Just to tell you, there were, so none of, teachers will say to me, but how do I cover the expectations and do this? There is no and here, it's an or. So I am covering expectations. You don't have to do both things, you just do this. Because you're doing what you're supposed to do. Now, does that mean you won't ever like just be boring? Of course, we're all boring sometimes. It's just that it's just like a little piece, not like all the time. Here's a different learning goal. I can show different things about a number by using different representations of that number. You remember that was actually a big idea. So I'm going to go primary now. I might say to kids, here's my mind's on, my getting started, whatever you call it. You see, there is 16 there. I swear, I see 16 there. What does that picture tell me about 16? So talk at your table for a minute. What do you see about 16 by looking at that picture?
One more. Or three groups of four.
Yeah.
Four groups.
Three groups of four,
right.
Plus one group of three and one
extra. Plus one extra.
Yeah.
All right, so we're not going to take a ton of time. We're just going there. Table over there, tell us something you see about 16 from that picture.
didn't have much time to discuss, but
I know.
You can see that it's, you can see that it's four floors.
You can see that it's four fours, and I'm betting that some people can't see that it's four fours there. And she can, that's all good. And so I'm gonna say, hey, I don't like see the four fours. Like, where do you see the four fours? I totally get where she sees the four fours. Do you understand that? But my job as a teacher is to say that, because I swear to you, there's people who have no clue where her four fours are. You okay with that? So she saw four fours. I would bet money that most kids don't see four fours. But like, I totally get where she saw it, I'm good. So I'd let her talk, we're not doing it. Okay, what did you see at the table here?
So three groups of five and one.
Three groups of five and one more. So she saw that it's three groups of five and one more. Okay, what did you guys see?
So sort of the same way we said, it's a little more than 15.
It's a little more than 15, that's great. What did you guys see?
We saw the three fives and
three five. Fives and one more. What did you guys see?
Three groups of four, one group of three, and one extra.
Ooh, okay, so three groups of four, one group of three, one extra. Where did you see that? We'll talk about.
We saw the three groups of five.
Three groups of five, one more. So people see whatever they want to see, it's all good. More people saw three groups of five and one more than the other thing, that's all good. I could say I see that 16 is not something you say when you count by fives. Do you agree with me? So you can still infuse like other stuff. You okay with that? All right. So then I might say, how about this picture? Like, what do you see here? So we're not going to do it all. But do you see this one, the four fours, is like in your face? Whereas in the other one, it was like way hidden. Is everybody cool with that? So I want kids to see that when you represent a number of different ways, some different things might be in your face. That's what I want out of this. But other kids might see other things in there. I see that this tells me 16 is even. Do you agree? So how does it tell me it's even? Well, she said it was a box, which it totally is, but that still doesn't tell me why that makes it even. You can make two parts that are equal. Hey, buds, that is why it's even. Is that good? Like, do you understand this is like good talk? So it's even because you can split it in two and the two halves look identical. That is why it's even. Some people will say it's even because I see groups of two. That's also why it's even. Like, you get different things out of it. So all cool. Okay. Then I might say, if I asked you to draw a picture that showed me that 16 is 9 less than 25, I want to see it in my face, that 16 is 9 less than 25, what picture would you draw? So do that.
You can talk, you can work together.
I made a box and then I colored in the 9 that was a 3x3 section. So you colored in your 16. And then you colored in your 9 on both on the outside, so you have your 16.
Yeah, I was trying to think of how to show.
Yeah, it's good.
You can cross out.
5x3, just take groups of 4. I can see that that's 9.
Yeah. Can you say that again, Mama?
So I did these groups of 4, okay. So you can see 8 and 1 is 9.
Oh, okay.
But the 16 might not be as obvious. So you're, to me, that's
so how did you?
4, 8, 12, 16. And 4, 8, 1 is 25.
So you went with tallies.
Yeah.
Probably because I went with tallies the first time.
Yeah.
Okay, that's good. Which you did good too.
I did 2 seconds.
I mean, this
okay.
Oh, I like that too.
Yeah.
All right, so this is another time where I'm going to be good.
Did you do the 3x3?
No, for real, for me to walk around and show you what different people did. And it's just that I was too lazy to get online and do all this stuff. But do you understand that you would want different people, like I've already talked to people who went in totally different directions. I'm doing this minds on, so let me just talk about it. Frequently, kids don't really know where you want to go. So I'm actually doing this minds on to be like really tight about like where we're going to go, guys, because this is where we're going to go, is show me 25 in lots of ways and tell me something each way shows me about 25. I don't know that they'll know what to do unless I go through this thing. So I've actually modeled it with them a couple ways where we talked about what do you see, what do you see. And it wasn't, they were still divergent thinking. Like people saw different things, it's all good. So I'm showing them what to do, but not like tight, tight, tight. I'm showing them what I mean. I'm giving them a little opportunity here to make a picture that does it before I set them to the task. So the reason I'm saying this is, I think part of the reason we waste time is kids sit there have no clue what you want out of them. And they just like spin their wheels for like way too long. And then by the time like they get it, it's like time to consolidate already. So I guess I'm old school enough to believe that if I really care about them knowing where I want to go, like help them know. Now helping them know doesn't mean you do it for them, because I'm not doing it for them. But I'm helping them like know what I'm going for. So you can decide how you feel about that, but that's why I'm doing what I'm doing. So when you do this picture, we'll hear what some people did, and then we'll see what are the common threads that we hear when we hear about the pictures. Okay, so somebody in the back table, tell us what your picture looked like.
I built a 5x5 array,
yep.
And in it I found a 3x3, so I had like 25, and then my 9, and then I just verified that there are 2 arrays that are left of those 6.
Beautiful. So she had the 25, and inside her 25, she saw the 9 part, which you made 3 groups of 3, and she also saw a 16 part. So in her picture, she saw both the 25 and the 16 and the 9 too. Like they're all sitting there. Okay. All right. What did you guys do? Did your picture look like hers or different?
Mine was similar to her picture.
Similar to her picture.
Yeah, it was a 5x5, but I counted off the first 9, and then the rest of them colored a different color to represent the 9.
Beautiful. Okay, that's great. All right, anybody do something different? You did tallies. Tell them about your tallies.
I did tallies, so I did 4 groups of, 5 groups of 4 with 1 left over.
She did 5 groups of 4.
6 groups of 4.
6 groups of 4 with 1 left over. And so when you did your, what did your 6 groups of 4 look like? The 4 without the little crossy guy?
No, I put the crossy guy.
The crossy guy. All right, so that's the technical term. So yes. Here's the crossy guy. So here is a group of 5, a group of 5, a group of 5, a group of 5, and no, a group of 4. And the 4 at the end. And the crossy guy, like you all understand what I mean by the crossy guys, are sitting there. And she has 5 little crossy guys and 4 more. Are you cool with that? And that's where her 9 came from. I'll say it one more time. Group of 5, group of 5, group of 5. Group of 5, did I say it right? And 4 more? No?
4.
All right, I lied. So what did you say?
I did group of 4, group of 4, group of 4, group of 4, group of 4.
Okay, so you did not have crossy guys.
Yeah, I had crossy guys for my 4. I had 3 and a crossy guy. Group of 3.
Oh, my God. Okay, so she had, okay, that's why we had crossy guys. We're all good. So she had a group of 4. She did her own style tally. I'm good. Group of 4, group of, so there's 6 groups of 4 there. And then where did you see the 16?
The 4 groups of
4 groups of 4, and then she looked at what's left over,
2 groups
and
of
she
four
saw
and
2 groups of 4 and 1. Okay, I'm good. All right. All right. Anybody go different? Yeah.
I added a reverse L.
Okay, good. So some of you used the picture that was sitting in front of you, and you get the two guys here. You have to add 4 guys, and a corner guy, which is 9 guys, to make 25. Several people did that. Is everybody okay with that? Do you understand how much math we just like did? Just in this like tiny like little question. And most of the math stuff that we did was relationships. Then my job is for kids to see that every single one of you in your picture had the 16 and the 25 happening in your picture and the 9. You can't show me that 16 is 9 less than 25 if we don't have a picture that shows all of those amounts. So like that's what I want kids to get out of that, but there's different ways. What's interesting is not a single one of you said, but maybe you did, used a number line. Did anyone?
Yeah.
Good. So tell us about your number line.
Well, these guys started ahead of me, and I was pretty sure they were doing a raise.
Okay.
I wanted to do something differently.
Good.
So my number line started with 0 on the left and 25 on the right. Then when I drew it, I did a jump from 25 back to 16, and then I showed the 9 at the top.
Good. So it could be a number line. I'm only saying that because a number line is one of those tools that we should use more often. And so I'm just pointing that out. But any one of those strategies used was great. Then I'm going to say something like, show the number 25 in lots of different ways. Each time, tell me one thing you see about 25 in your representation. So we're just going to do a short version of it at your table. Find 3 different ways to show 25. Nothing you already saw. Like, those are off. Something new, show 25 3 different ways as a group. And then each time say, oh, I see this about 25. Oh, I see this. Oh, I see this. Is everybody cool with that? I'm just going to say one more thing before you start, because I noticed it and I thought I should say something. You're grown-ups, and so you have every right to have your own little notebooks with your own little pieces of paper to work on your own. But that's what you do, is you work on your own. So one of the reasons we give one sheet of paper to 2 kids, or one notebook to 2 kids, or one piece of chart paper to 4 kids, is that makes them collaborate. When you have your own, you don't collaborate. So one of the things that's really interesting is a lot of people are going to technology, and technology makes you go alone again. If you have your own tablet, you're in charge of it, like you don't want anybody messing with you. Whoever has the tablet, like, they're doing everything. So just be aware of that. So I was watching you all go individual, and so it's just something I noticed that I'd mentioned, but keep going. So do the problem. That's great. That's good.
It's okay, happy to share with you. Right. All put dots on my iPad. My iPad, it's all yours.
This is what I did. That was my way of showing 25.
That's a quarter.
Oh. I'm glad somebody was able to pick that up.
Okay, I've got one.
Are you, was that Evernote that you like? What are you using?
Mobility.
But look, you know what's interesting? If I do this and I say that it's a new number,
then it's going to be in the top. But you're ignoring
the Exactly. But I, that's what I was, that was the mistake that I was going to recognize.
And that's good?
Yeah.
So you have to say to a kid, did you count everybody? And then you have to get them to know those 4.
So it's not even after all,
you do
the connecting dots. So. I can actually.
I always put a question. I always put a little question. Probably because I had so many X's.
What does a quarter look like?
No, there's a character one.
Yeah.
Is that a quarter?
But it's
that. Would we need to show it's a quarter of a dollar?
Well, it represents 25 cents, right? So that's a way to show that you 25, and it's showing 25 cents,
right?
Yeah. Okay. I know.
I was thinking of a quarter of an hour.
Quarter of an hour?
Yeah.
To get 25?
To get 25. But that, because I mean, you can show 25 minutes on the clock, but when we say, but no, we have to show 25, sorry.
Yeah, not a quarter.
So, but we can show 25 minutes on the clock. And it shows us that it's just less than half an hour.
Because what we'll see is we'll see kids not just putting stuff on there and not recognizing that there's a dashboard, another board, another board.
How are you showing 25? You're writing it big and you're writing it small.
I was goofing around.
Can we do 5 square?
How would you draw that?
It doesn't say, just show the number of 25.
Square root of.
I guess you could show the 5 by like the array, right?
5, 5,
yeah.
You could do 75 divided by 3.
Mm-hmm. Now, is that showing the number or is that showing the value?
Tell one thing each way shows you a value.
Oh.
Bless you.
What did show me?
So your 10 plus 10 plus 25?
Two groups of 10 and one by one.
Like,
okay, so tell me one of those things. So what is this one? Tell me about 25.
It tells me that it's 25 cents, and that means that it's a quarter of 100.
How do I know it's a quarter of 100? Like, I don't see 100.
Because it's we call it a quarter because it's a quarter of a dollar.
Okay, so how would you convince me that it really is a quarter of a dollar?
Because I know that it takes 4 of the quarters
to make the ounce. That's all I need to know. And so I would probably push you to show the other quarters. This guy is a quarter. So I'm pushing you, not because you don't already know it, because you actually already know it. I'm pushing you because my job is to worry about everybody else, not you right now. And how do I take the fact that you get this to kids who don't know why you call it? I need to do something for them.
Right.
So what I do is go back and say, what does that show me? What does that show me? What does that show me? Because I think that's a hard thing for kids. It's a hard thing for you, for teachers to like tell me.
Right.
Yeah. We need more practice.
Yeah.
So this, does this show, what does this
show? All right, I'm stopping you wherever you are because it's 5 to 11. Here we go. All right, so you would give kids more time. We're faking it today. We're shortcutting everything just for me to give you some ideas. As I've gone around to tables, my experience has been that if I say, what does it show you about 25? You are telling me things that are not actually there. Like, you know these things, but like they're not there or you haven't really formulated it. And I think the teaching job is to help kids learn, like, what do you actually say to answer this question? And I don't think it's a natural thing. Like, I think it's a learned behavior. Are you okay with that? So I might start something like this. Does anybody have a picture that easily shows us that 25 is 5 fives? Because that's a pretty safe one. Is everybody cool with that?
Yeah.
So somebody tell us, do you understand? It could have been tally marks. It could have been like 5 rows of 5. Like, there's lots of ways to do this. It could have been 5 nickels. Are you all okay with that?
Yeah.
And my job is, well, I see the 5 nickels, but where's the 25? Is my job. So here, listen, is that one hard? A kid puts 5 nickels, and instead of being like super happy, like you can be a little happy, but like don't get like over the moon yet. You have to say, but like, where's the 25? And you have to push them to say, well, the 25 is essentially the quarter I would trade for the 5 nickels. You are okay. Or the 25 is the total amount of cents. He hasn't shown you 25 yet. He's making you like guess where 25 is. Do you understand that a lot of kids, as they go up the grades and they do various sorts of tests and they get feedback, struggle with communication because nobody's taught them what is required in communication. That is your job, is like to show them like what you got to ask. So if a kid does 5 nickels, it's beautiful, but they did not show me where the 25 is. So I have to like not be mad at them, just like ask them, like, where's the 25 part? Like, I see the 5 bytes, but I don't like see the 25. So like, where is it? And they just have to like learn those behaviors. And so we're not testing them now, we're teaching them now, like where that, how to say that. Is everybody cool with that? I might ask, did anybody show me that 25 was an odd number? So look at all the things you did. Did anybody super clear that 25 is an odd number? Okay, so tell me how you did it, somebody. Who did it? Yeah.
We did 2 groups of 12 and 1 less.
Beautiful. If you had a group of 12 and a group of 12 and one guy over, you totally showed it to me. Is everybody cool with that? Now you could have lined them up or not. It doesn't matter. If there's a 12 and a 12 and a guy left over, you showed me it's odd. Are you cool? Yeah, absolutely. You could certainly do that. Okay. Everybody cool with that? So do you get, so listen hard, if you showed me 5 rows of 5, you did not show me that 25 is odd. You did not. It still is, like it didn't change, but you don't see it. You just don't see it. You gotta do other stuff to see it. I want kids to know that. And the problem that kids have is their teachers don't know that. So I'm telling you that this is back to, do you really understand what all these words mean? And teachers are just people and they didn't learn it. And so yeah, they don't understand yet. So part of your leadership role is not be mad at them, just help them see like the difference between what this sounds like and what this sounds like. Did anybody have a picture that made it like super clear that 25 is more than 20? Yeah, so what was your picture?
2 10 frames and 1 row of this.
Beautiful. 2 10 frames and another row means you got more than 20 because it was just 2 10 frames for the 20. Do you understand that some pictures actually showed me that 25 was more than 20, but like some not so much? In terms of being super clear. Did anyone draw a picture? You probably didn't, but like maybe somebody did. That shows me 25 is just not a bunch of threes. Like you really try, you like threes, you made lots of threes, and it just like didn't work. And you get maybe like nobody did that. That's totally cool. But now somebody's gonna try it. Like, do you understand that in a group of 20 kids, like somebody's gonna try it now. And then he's gonna make groups of threes, and I'll be watching for who's doing it, and I'll say, so like tell us, Fred, why it didn't work, and he's going to tell us he had a guy left over. Like, do you understand this was like the 16 tally marks with a 15 and 1? That's what this was about. So I could do that. Sean did an interesting one. So Sean drew a 25 degree angle, which is cool. And we had a long discussion at that table that if a teacher saw this, she would be like super excited. Wow, an angle. But Sean still didn't tell me what it tells me about 25. Like there's an angle, like there it is. So my job as a teacher is to, I can be excited, but my job is to go back and say, so what does that tell me about 25? And I have to push to make Sean do that. So even though he did a really great thing, you still didn't tell me what it is about 25. In the end, what Sean did was he made a 90 degree angle and a 45 degree angle. And he told me that 25 was like about half of the 45. Can you all visualize that? So that's a great thing. It told me that 25 is about half of 45. I'm good. But I don't think teachers ever learn to do this, because I've done this a lot of times with teachers. So like I can speak with fairly good certainty that teachers haven't learned to do this. And so they don't know how to get kids to do it because like they don't know how to do it yet. But it's not like rocket science. It's not hard to learn. You just have to like decide this is worth learning. I'm telling you that in this stupid little activity about 16 and 25, we have covered a ton of expectations and topics. We did stuff about factors and multiples, and we did stuff about skip counting by five. Like, we just did a lot of stuff. So it's better than a tight little problem that doesn't, like, go that far. and it speaks to like an important idea that the reason I change 25 to 20 plus 5 sometimes, but 30 minus 5 other times, is because sometimes this is useful, but sometimes that is useful. So that's where I'm going in the long run, but I'm going to do it in the short run, like over lots and lots and lots of times, over lots and lots and lots of grades, for kids to learn that you just don't represent things a lot of ways because they told you to. You did it because sometimes this is useful and sometimes that is useful. Kids are by and large obedient, and so they'll do it for the most part, but like they're not getting what you want out of it. They're just like doing it because you told them to do it. And that's essentially what teachers are too, obedient. And so the ministry says in a document, represent stuff lots of ways. So teachers are very good and they do it. But if you don't know purpose, it's really hard to make it meaningful enough. So this is back to deconstructing expectations. Are you okay with that? All right. So the expectations of addressing, there were a few of them, you can look at them later. All right, so we'll do more examples, but at this point, let's do another pause. Do you see how lesson goals give meaning to a phrase like represent numbers to 10,000 in a variety of ways? But that's exactly what it says in the document, that part one of the expectations is representing numbers to 10,000 in a variety of ways. What this thing I'm trying to do now is about giving meaning to what that is. So essentially, we're back to the question I asked you like an hour ago. Is this doable? Is it important enough to be doable? Nobody's committing to anything now. You're just saying, is this something that we should consider and eventually reject or not reject, whatever you want, but is this something to consider as a focus being making meaning out of all those overall or specific expectations? So talk one more time, having gone through a few more experiences. Has anything changed for you? So like, you don't have to rehash what you said before. Like we've done a couple more things now. Have your feelings about it changed or not changed? That's all I want you to talk about. So talk to each other.
And you know, that's when I was, I mean, I'm thinking at a secondary level right now, and one of the things that I was, we get so stuck in our mindset in terms of what that expectation means to me and how I cover that expectation. You know, like I'm thinking about some of the history expectations and that sort of stuff. Where I know that they always do like a poster on the prime minister or something. You know, like there's always, that's the way they cover that expectation. And I just think it would be really interesting in order for teachers of different disciplines to try to interpret what the expectations mean from those other ones and actually try to get some meaning out of it and then share that with each other. Because if you continue to come from it strictly from one perspective and you don't know all the, like, so again, it would be something, right? Like from a primary teacher to an intermediate teacher looking at those expectations. Well, what does that really mean? It gives you a different perspective in terms of, instead of just, well, I always cover that by doing this.
And I think he touched on, like, Kevin Machiar would say, if I walk into a classroom and I see a child do this, I want to know why you chose to do that learning activity with that particular child at this particular time.
Yeah.
Why? And if you can't answer that question, you've got a problem. So that intentionality, so under the full understanding of the intentionality of choosing the right thing to do that child at that particular time. Because I need to cover the expectations, it's not quite the answer.
Yeah. Well, it's also, you know, that's why you don't know what to do, and they don't read it.
Yeah,
taking it on a superficial level. So what I'm beginning to see, when I understand it more, I can ask some of those other questions. I'm going to know more of what I'm looking for, as opposed to they got it or they didn't.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So you start thinking more beyond the expectations.
that really helps. I have to say, she said earlier, but it's so much easier to do now because
So I'm still, and I know that because we had in the last time that we talked about it, you were saying you like to dive into what the big ideas are, because otherwise it's instead of teaching the students or teaching the teachers how to ask the questions, it's just like part of the course. I agree that we need to dive into and try to analyze what those big ideas are, but I think that requiring teachers to ask those questions and force them to do that learning themselves and find ways of doing that. So we say that we want. We want it to be student-directed learning within our classrooms. And then we go and we make it very teacher-directed in the way that we approach our teachers. You know, like, our students are our teachers, right? And so if we want them to direct their learning and recognize that they need to be asking some of these questions, then they have to take that leadership in order to say, that means I need to figure out what these expectations are. And so that they then drive their own instead of us being a top-down, this is what these expectations mean, therefore now you
I'm
can
not suggesting you should tell them. I think that is a better starting point than
right.
Questions.
Yes.
So why not let them know that? So they'll be trying to go, I think it'll go like this.
Right.
It's not this, and then this. And go, they're
yeah.
going to, it's like doing it right. They're going to feel each other.
Yeah.
And I know her, as soon as people feel they're being forced or they're put in a
yes,
but you get politeness. Oh yes, and then nothing happens.
Right.
So I mean, why not be right up front? This now have a different understanding,
yes.
But from the experience I've had talking to them, this might be a starting point for the staff.
Yeah,
you're free to take it any way you want, but this can work. And then it just—I think if we do some of the work to get them going. Then you'll get more buy-in. Otherwise, the people, I think, there's a lot of teachers that have terrible math phobia.
Oh, yeah.
So we really have to coddle them, I think, to get them to buy-in.
And you know what? And I guess, and we are looking at it because I'm. Primarily, I work with high school math teachers. And so
you just fluent in math and so on. I mean, you just dipsy doodle in. But most people aren't like that.
Well, and that's, but most of the teachers that I work with are. And so that's you know, like, because I work with high school math teachers. So I think that's the other part of it, too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or so when I'm with teachers, it's not.
And they don't understand. Yeah, they don't understand
where
the math is going.
Showing, or what I'm seeing,
some
I'm
are
not
are.
Understanding.
Yeah.
So I'm thinking, so how can we make a nice safe space as you for small classes to have some
yeah.
fun exploring?
Okay, I'm going to interrupt you, and
yeah.
we'll do it more collaboratively now. There's nothing you're supposed to say. You're just going to say what you're thinking. So I asked you, are you feeling any differently than you felt before? And you obviously were all talking because I interrupted you. So what kind of conversations are you having? This is sort of the main purpose today, so I don't care how much else I do. What conversations are you having?
You were just looking at what we were working on and how it's important that teachers understand those essential understanding students from the curriculum.
Sorry, Nina, it's really hard to hear you over here.
Sorry, okay. We were looking at the curriculum and talking about how teachers may have an understanding of the curriculum, but what does that actually mean for essential understandings? And if you don't understand what you're actually looking for at the end, it's going to be really difficult to ask those good questions, right? If you don't have that end in mind, those big ideas that makes those connections for the students, right? So if you work on that curriculum piece, then that questioning piece may be easier because you may know where the student, where you want to take the student.
All right. So the document, I mean, different documents are written in different ways. The way it's written right now, anyway, isn't helping uncover those essential understandings. Okay. And so she's thinking that maybe it is worth finding out what they are to help you. This might, the rest might go more easily if you could do that. All right. What happened at your table? Two of them disappeared. That's one thing that happened. All right. What else happened?
We were at the point where we were saying, how do we improve the kind of system? So we talked about principal meetings, directors meetings, and how if principals are going to be co-learners with their teachers, how can they learn to, you know, be a co-learner, not be the expert, go back and learn with their teachers and try this on and then come back in a trusting environment with their peers and try again.
Okay.
This is something that's not going to happen quickly.
For sure. Like, if it was going to happen quickly, it would have, like, already happened. Okay. All right. So she said a couple things that I think are worth talking about. There is lots of talk about admin being co-learners, which I agree. But admin aren't just co-learners. They are the people with the higher expectations. That's what they have to carry. So one of the things, I mean, one of the reasons I'm here is that you actually find out that when there's what I'm going to call a knowledgeable other in a group, it changes the environment. So in a lot of environments, I think it's great for the admin to be the co-learner, but there has to be somebody in the group who is, I'm just going to call him the pusher. The pusher means we don't just like status quo, like you ask hard questions, like what about this, but what about that? And it doesn't have to be somebody who has like books written. It has to be someone who knows how to, in a social situation, push a group in a positive direction. So one of the things that's important is that even though we can say we want the admin to be a co-learner, I'm actually telling you that they also have to know whether it's them or somebody else, which is totally fine. There has to be someone in that room who asks hard questions or you're not getting anywhere. I'm just going to say it out loud. Like, it feels good, but you're not going to change anything. Things get changed. So when Stephen Katz writes about intentional interruptions, it's just another way to say there has to be a pusher in the room. So I actually think it's a valuable thing to tell admin that they have to be involved. I totally agree. But you have to be very careful when you say be involved, but you don't have to be the leader. Like, that's true, but do you understand their job is to make sure there is a leader in that group? Do you follow? It doesn't have to be them, but there bloody better be somebody who just pushes a little. I don't mean in a negative way. I mean just ask harder questions.
Knows the questions.
Knows the questions. So my experience has been, I've been sitting in PLCs and like wondering why we just spent that 2 hours. Because it feels nice and, you know, people are social and they like it and that's all good, but you're not changing systems that way. So you need someone who doesn't, like, it's not like a radical, it's just someone who asks some harder questions about how you're going to get things changed. And so I think it's a great thing. So I think even though we really do need admin to be at the table for sure and learn with teachers and whatever, they can't lose that part of their responsibility is this, like, holding expectations and communicating that and whatever it is, even though in that particular milieu, they not may not be the person who's doing the pushing. So if you've been, like, I really believe that. Every school that I've seen change had someone like that, usually the principal, in honesty. Like, not being like hard-nosed, but just like pushing. Cool.
Can you be the pusher without the content knowledge?
I think it's hard. I think, but you don't need, like, I happen to be lucky that I have like a ton of content knowledge because I've been doing this for like a super long time and I had a lot of training. I don't think you need to be me at all. I think you need to know enough to push. I don't think you have to be like an expert at, if that makes any sense to you. But you can't know nothing.
So, Marian, I mean, that's part of the reason our group has
come
together to learn enough.
Yep.
Can you talk to systems that have been working with their principals and some of the strategies that systems
for sure.
Using to get principals to a place where they have enough.
Yep. So this gets awkward, but I'll just like tell you who it is. So I have a friend who is a principal who's actually writing materials for principals to help them know what to do. So that's just, that is there. But he is a friend, so we've had lots of conversations. And I can tell you that as a principal, he has turned several schools around in like less than 2 years. And there's a variety of reasons. He's very skilled. But one of the things his board has decided to do, and it's something for you to think about, is he has a new job next year. He's been a principal of schools. His new job next year is called principal coach. His job is to coach other principals. Like that is his system job. So he has been taken out of his school. His job is to help other principals learn what you got to do because he's lived it and he's been effective at doing it. So I think that's like something to think about. So it was his director who made this decision. I didn't know about it. Like she told me, she decided to make this job happen because she had him and knew like she had the person to make it happen. But essentially, most of us need somebody who we believe understands like their space, but who kind of can help you know what to do differently. So one of the ways this particular board, which is in Ontario, has decided to move is to have a principal coach. And it's just like some of your system leaders is something that you can take back. So if you believe principals are key, I think like they are, it's worth thinking about. In some boards, I'm actually, like in one particular board, nameless board, I'm actually working with admin 4 times next year, like 4 days with me and admin, just talking about what it is they should be looking for because they just don't know. They go to a ministry meeting and they hear this, and then they go to a ministry meeting and they hear that. And like, it's just confusing and there's so much stuff. A lot of it is just jargony and some of it is conflicting and they just, it's hard. So in some places they're just like really taking their admin and doing that. There's another board, all nameless. This board, this was an interesting experience for me. This board has a lot of schools in it and I worked in a lot of schools. And each time I went to a school, I would talk to the principal by email or on the phone before I went in planning what we were going to do that day. And I can say with zero exceptions, and there were like a lot of calls, that I knew with that conversation whether it was a wasted day or not. Every single time, like no exceptions. So there would be people who say, I want you to do this and we're working on this and whatever. And usually that principal was there all day and they were working and those felt like good days. Then there would be other ones who would say, well, what do you want to do? Like, they're just doing a checklist. They offered me to a school. They said, sure, I'm too busy. Like, they're not there. Like, whatever. Like, every single time, zero exceptions. So principals are pretty critical. So I said to one of the superintendents in that board, who I know, I'm just telling you the facts. I said to that person, do you want me to tell you which days were a waste of time? And that person said no. So that means all I'm doing is there's a checklist and we needed a guest in math. We did it. We're done. So that senior admin doesn't care what's happening, in honesty. So they would tell me, the same senior admin, that they would have principal meetings and invite principals, but they often didn't come. And so I would like naively say, well, did you tell them they had to? And they said, well, no. So like you're saying, duh, you know? So essentially, unless senior admin makes principals believe that this is what they see as sort of the most important part of their job right now, it ain't happening. Unless it's an exception of a person who chooses on their own to be that person. So I've been saying to higher people, like directors, that it's your court. Like if you want it to be a priority, it could be a priority. If you don't make it a priority, it won't. So part of it is getting them to the table and making it seem like that's the thing you care about the most right now. Like it's not forever, it's like for now. This is like priority one. So if you have a choice of going here and going there, you're going there. Like you have to, it's everybody gets it. Like everybody knows it. It's crystal clear. So that means that comes from super top that this is the deal. It means that SOs
are involved in stuff, not just principal. Like, it means all these things. Then you have to decide what you're going to focus on. And I think that part of, like, there's a lot of stuff to do, but part of it is, why is changing math so much bloody harder than changing other things? And you have to address it, and then you have to talk about what are we going to do about it, and what do you want that change in math to look like? Because they just don't know. Right now, they think if kids are looking happy, busy, and touching stuff, it's all good. Now, the right things, touching the right things. But it isn't like always all good, you know? And so these are poor little people who don't have any more training than anybody else to know what's really valuable. So that is where you need people who kind of know what's valuable to speak, to help them know what's valuable. So when I'm doing these big ideas with you, like, no principal I know, except for a couple of people, would have ever, like, known this stuff. That was not part of their training. And so, like, they are owed an opportunity to, like, see what it means. And you have to be, like, delicate and good about providing those opportunities. But then they have to do a payback. So the payback is that, what are you going to do with what we did today? So a lot of times we ask for sessions to be, you don't want a one-off, you want another session, and there should be some obligation for what did you do between those times. Like, there has to be obligation. So we ask it of teachers, we should ask it of admin. So you either tell them what they have to do, or you ask them which of these things they're going to do, but there has to be an obligation, and they have to come back and fulfill those obligations. So we don't always, like, follow through on those things, and I think that's a system fault, that you don't follow through. So I was at a board, unnamed again. It was high school, and they had been given, like, time off to prepare a lesson together. They were all going to teach it. We were going to talk about it when I came back. I swear to God, this really happened. You went to a table, and you said, well, most good, but then you go to a table, so where's your lesson? I swear they said, I left it home. And then the next person, believe it or not, also left it home. And, like, two more people left at home. And then one person just, like, opens his computer and just gives me a random lesson and said, like, this was the lesson. Like, I'm not stupid. So the deal was that, so you tell the superintendent, like, you pay those guys for a half a day to plan this lesson. And they just didn't care. Like, I don't get it. So I'm just, like, a little taxpayer person, like, wondering, like, why are we paying people for those days off, you know, doing that kind of stuff? So it's a bit, I mean, in the end, it is about accountability, but we make people accountable, like, I think, for the wrong stuff sometimes. So we're accountable for some stuff, but, like, not for other stuff. And so it seems to me that professional learning has to be an accountability issue, and right now it's not. It's a maybe issue. And so you can't just dictate, you know, you will attend so many sessions, because you could be there in body but not spirit. But we have to make it a culture where that's, like, that is the accountability part. Like, that's what we care about. Like, yeah, you have to show up at a certain time and you can't leave until a certain time, but, like, this other stuff is equal. And it's not equal yet. And the public doesn't think it's equal too. Like, you know that. Like, they only count the minutes you're in front of small people. And get upset about all those other minutes. So we have a big cultural problem. It's not just, but the cultural problem isn't solved until the teaching profession itself solves it. Like, you've got to believe it first if you're going to want the public to believe it. And I don't think we got there yet. So I don't know. It's just interesting for me. So I'm serious. Like, I actually was a school trustee, and you wonder, in New Brunswick, not here. And one of the things that was really interesting is when the teachers were on work action, they were told by their association, you have to attend staff meetings, but you're not allowed to attend professional learning. To me, that's, like, backwards. Because you're actually signaling what matters the most. And it's the wrong matters, like, for me. But that's just, like, me. So I think that the big issue is that the system believes this is critical work. Until that happens, I think it'll all be pockets and random. When the system believes this is critical work, and the principals believe that the system they're in believes this, then I think things change, because we just respond to stuff. We just all do. Like, when your boss wants stuff, you kind of do that stuff. So I don't know. I could be simplistic about that, but that's what I see. And the only time I see other is there are always in every profession people who just have like some amazingness about them. And they don't need any of us anyway. So I don't know. I don't think there's a quick answer about what you do. But I do think I don't think principals have to do 5 million math problems. It's good for them to be involved for sure. But I think their involvement needs to be purposeful. They need to see that they're doing this math problem, not just because like they're told they have to be co-learners. They have to see like what happens to kids when they do problems like this? Like what happens to you when you do problems like this? How do you feel differently? What effect does it have on you? How does seeing connections help you? Like they have to see, like you can't just randomly say do a problem. Like I believe purposeful. Yeah.
Yeah, and one of the things I think I've been reflecting on as a system leader doing math problems and being sometimes very uncomfortable with math problems is recognizing how challenging this would be for a teacher who's never experienced math this way to have to do it by themselves. And when we think about Northern Ontario and the fact that we've got teachers in isolated communities, maybe the only grade 5-6 teacher in that, for hundreds of miles. How do we help bring people together to network or have those conversations or answer the questions?
And that is obviously a place where technology really is effective. None of us are as isolated as we used to be. Like, period, we're just not. Like, every one of us is like connected all over the place, like all the time. And so the advantage of technology is that we don't have to be alone if we don't want to be. But we also have to have a system that sort of communicates implicitly versus explicitly, it doesn't matter to me, to a teacher, like, I don't want you to be alone. Mm. And they have to know, like, you want them to be interacting with teachers in other places, and you want that to happen. And you don't, I'm saying it, like, in this very explicit way. It doesn't happen like, hey, you're calling another teacher. It's like, it just, like, feels like that's what we guys do.
But it's also understanding, like, if the teachers understand that we get it, right? We know that some of this stuff is not easy to wrap our heads around, but we'll support the learning
absolutely.
If you need it, right?
And it's important, absolutely. Collaboration. Yeah. So my buddy, who's this principal that I'm telling you about, he's very focused on doing a lot of across panel tasks. We change them for panels. Like, you can't ask the same thing of a kindergarten kid than grade 8. Like, you just mostly can't. But they're along the same lines, and there's just like, they're varied. So he just sent me some tasks to react to that he's using now. So his kindergarten people are doing this one, and his, you know, this grades are doing this one, and these grades are doing this one, but they're related tasks. And then the teachers have to come together and talk about what it looked like for them. So his is across the grades. It isn't necessarily a 5 talking to a 5. It's panels interacting. And his belief is that the reason he's been successful is that there is a common feeling in the school. And so all the teachers are on the same page in the school, because they're all focused on accomplishing the same goals in the school. And I've met some of his teachers, so he certainly doesn't tell them what to do day by day. Like, they have lots of autonomy, but like, they're all going in a common direction. And all we can say is it's worked for him, like, in a couple of places, like, really well. And it's not just him, because he has two other buddies who are sort of taking it on. And I was with one of those buddies on the day she got some data back from her kids. And in, like, no time at all, kids had, like, jumped, like, hurdles. Like, so much happened in just a little bit of time with their focus. So nobody has like the answer. Nobody has the answer. But essentially his belief, and he's has some evidence, is that getting my whole staff in the same direction, still with autonomy, obviously, has been powerful for him. Because it is hard on kids. Like, I'm with her, but she likes us to do that. But when you go to him, like, no way. And so half the teachers I meet say to me, well, I want to do this, but when they get to her, like, that won't work anymore. So they feel like they can't do it anymore. So, like, having people in the same direction is valuable.
Yeah, and I can share with you that we actually have been in contact with the principal that Marian is referring to, and do hope to share some of his insights with the larger group at some point in the future. So
yeah. So there are, like, I mean, he has a lot of skill sets that make him a very effective principal. Not everybody has all the same skill sets, but what he has isn't magic. Like, it could happen with other people too. So the idea is, and I think it is about a kind of change in culture that you're focused on, and that's why I believe he feels that the whole school working on and in together across panels is important, because he's working on that culture change in the school. So if you have a culture change in a school, it affects kids and it affects parents, and you don't have like fights all the time, you know, well, I want her over there because like she does this, and you know, you don't have any of that stuff. So it's just something to think. All right, so that was like off topic, but definitely not. What other conversations happened? Like, we forgot what we were talking about. Right now. It's like, so long ago. I don't know. You have to decide, do you think that teachers can be helped and admin can be helped to see what these sort of bigger things are and whether those bigger things are important? So that really is our focus today, is looking bigger the answer, or is looking smaller the answer? So different, quote, experts will actually have different opinions on this. I think you'll hear different opinions on this with your little plans. And I don't know that anybody knows. I believe, based on a lot of years of experience, is that the problem in math is teachers are already too microscopic. And so I go for macro, because micro hasn't worked. So in literacy, teachers tend to be more macro. But in math, they tend to be more micro. And they look at this one, and this one, and this one, and this one. And I'm saying we've been micro for a long time. It hasn't worked all that effectively from my perspective. So try macro and see if that's like a better place to go. And the hardship about going macro is that teachers didn't learn math macro. And so it's harder for them to do it. They did learn literacy more macro. So. But because they feel okay in literacy, because it is macro, it does tell you, like, maybe that's a good direction. But they may need help on what are those macros. Does that make sense? I don't know. That's what I'm saying. Okay. And so I worry that if you go, like, micro, it's you're still going back to that stuff that isn't getting you to the place you want to be. All right. Okay, here's another big idea. I told Sherry Dunn when we started this, she told me that a number of you folks are working on mental math. So I just did choose a big idea about operations. Each operation has a variety of meaning, all of which are related. So subtraction can mean different stuff, and those meanings are related, but they're different. Any addition situation, here's an essential understanding, involves parts and a whole. You know the parts, but not the whole. Any subtraction situation involves parts and a whole. You know the whole and some of the parts. Are you okay with that? So that's what it, so subtraction doesn't mean takeaway. It means there's a whole and parts, and you know the whole and some of the parts, but not the rest of the parts. Any addition situation involves parts and a whole, and you know some, you know the parts, but you don't know, like, that's the gig. You okay with that? All right. Multiplication is an interesting one. So this is, I've been doing a lot of work on proportional reasoning in some of the boards in Ontario this lately. And so you start thinking about it, and so I have a new thought. This didn't appear in anything earlier. Multiplication is about changing units. So here's what I mean by that. If you think of a very simple problem like this, there are three plates with four cookies on each plate. How many cookies? Is everybody okay? Three plates, four cookies on a plate, how many cookies? I am doing a unit change. It was three if you call it plates, but it's 12 if you call it cookies. I'll say that one more time. Three plates, four cookies in a plate. There are three unit plates. But if you want a unit of cookies, you have to do this multiply guy. And it's 12 if the unit is cookies. Are you okay with that? So multiplication to me is essentially always about a unit change. And you want to change to a little unit when you multiply. Do you get that when you divide, you go the other way? You have little units and you want to make big units. So that's going to be part of what I'm saying it very fast. You have to think about this. I know that. But you have like lots of time. All right. There are lots of possible learning goals. Here might be a learning goal. I can show how the different meanings of subtraction are related. So there's lots of variations, but generally speaking, most of the researchers in math ed have established what they call three different meanings for subtraction. I think I list them here. One is called takeaway, one is called missing addend, and one is called comparison. So this is what that means. So here's the takeaway. Everybody knows takeaway. There are four apples. You ate three. How many are left? Is everybody cool? That's a takeaway. What was the whole and what were the parts? Four apples. You ate three. How many are left? What's the whole?
Four
apples. Three was a part. You're looking for the other part. Is everybody like cool with them? All right. Here is a missing addend meaning for 4 minus 3. I have $3 and I need $4. How much more do I need? I have $3. I need $4. How much more do I need? Are you good that the whole is four? You know the three part. You're looking for the one part. All right. And here is a third meaning. This is actually trickier. I have $4. You have $3. How much more do I have than you? Do you get this is weirdo because like there's extra holes around. Okay. So essentially the hole is still four. My four is made up of the three that I'm comparing to and the one extra I have. All of them were there's a hole of four, there's parts of three and one. I gave you the three, look for the one, even though they sound like super different. So I'm telling you this as teachers, I'm not gonna lecture kids like this, but that is where we're going. That every single subtraction we meet, really, they're all related. They all are about the same idea. They just like sound different. And I would tell you that this principle, by the way, what we've been talking about, this mythical principle, one of the things he actually focuses on are the meanings of subtraction. That's one of his big staff tasks they spent a ton of time working on at different levels. Because you get grade 7 and 8 kids are working on subtraction with fractions, but grade 5 and 4 kids are working on subtraction with like decimals or big numbers, and little guys are working on like little, like everybody's working on subtraction.
And it's really, really hard.
Yeah, and it's really, really hard. Nobody likes subtraction like by nature, and so it is complicated. Addition is nice for kids because it's so simple, like put it together, count it. Like that's all there is in addition, period. But subtraction means like this sometimes and this sometimes, like it's hard. So do you get that if your teachers don't know that, which some of them don't, it's gonna be hard for the kids because like they're depending on the big people to help them see it. So here could be a possible task. What numbers would you add or subtract to solve each problem? Tell me why, draw a picture to help show why. So here's my prompt. There were 12 apples, somebody ate eight. How many were left? Tell me, would I add or subtract those numbers? Tell me why I would add or subtract. Draw me a picture that helps me see why I added or subtracted. You okay with that? That's only part one. Part two. Jane had 12 bucks, Sarah had 8 bucks. How much more did Jane have? I want a picture. Do you understand half of the kids are now going to add 12 and 8? Because, I don't know, it says more. And so like you just add it. And so like you need to talk about it. And what does your picture look like? And how does that picture help you see that you subtract 8 from 12, you don't add 8 and 12? So I'm going for the visual to help you see why. And my third one is Jane had 8 bucks. She needed 12 bucks to buy something. How much more? Like I'm just addressing all this. Will every kid draw the same picture? Like, obviously not. Will they all draw good pictures? Like, obviously not. But your job is to kind of go through it and kind of use what they do to build to a consolidation that helps kids see that in the end, like this is the teaching idea. I'm telling you, most teachers I know don't know this is the teaching idea. The subtraction means there were parts in a whole. You know the whole, you know some parts, you look at other ones. Do you understand if kids knew that, that would be like good information? So part of it is to like help kids see the information they need. So I'm not gonna have you do that. So the consolidation might be, why did you subtract 12 and 8 each time instead of add them? So like, we'll talk about, like, why didn't you add them? Like, adding is like so much happier than subtracting, but like you subtracted, so how come you? And so you can do it in a fun and cute little way, but essentially you want kids to know, what is it that makes me add and what is it that makes me subtract? And I keep asking questions to go there. What was similar about the problems besides the numbers? So I know I use the same numbers, but like, what was similar about the problems? Really focus, I'm getting toward, there was always like this hole in the part, the hole in one of the parts. How did your picture show that there was a hole each time as well as a part? I want to see the hole in your picture. I want to see the parts. Like, where are they? Do you understand the comparison picture is going to be a hard one? It will be, because the hole is only part of the picture. That is so unsettling. Do you follow what I mean? And so you gotta deal with all that. And one of the pictures that we often use, I know it's hard to see here, is what they call it, a bar diagram. It's not just Singapore math, but there's some of the people use it. But essentially, 8 and 4 make 12 is in that diagram. Every single one of those problems could have been that diagram. So one of the reasons Singapore math probably has been successful for lots of kids, and it's used more in the west of Canada than in the east, and it's used more in the US than in Canada, is that you're actually helping to see that big connection between addition and subtraction, and there's a similar one with multiplication and division. Like, it's like in your face, like all the time. So when you have an addition situation, you always knew the little guys, but not the big guy. When you had a subtraction situation, you always knew the big guy and some of the little guys. And you were looking for the other little guys. So that could help kids like see connections. So this is part of, you know, visualization does help you kind of make sense of some of that. I'm addressing a whole bunch of expectations in that question. Solve a variety of problems, blah, blah, blah. Solve problems involving subtraction of single digit whole numbers, determine, using a balanced model, the number of identical objects that must be added or subtracted. So I'm kind of dealing with all of those things. So it's, again, not, I need teachers to know, this is huge. They're trying to do all these things we're showing them on top of everything they used to do that is physically impossible. So it's, you have to make them really believe you are covering the expectations, like, relax. But that's a hard work, because it's just like, you're shaking their ground, right? And shaking ground is hard. Yeah.
Marian, could you talk, we talked a little bit at break about the number of learning goals, that you wouldn't have a different learning goal every single day of the math class either, that
no,
you're spending time practicing those learning goals.
Yeah, so I'm going to say, I'll say it this way. I would definitely not have a different essential understanding every day. I might have a different learning goal lots of days, not every single day, but lots of days, because I want to give focus to my lesson. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a topic and I'm going to break it up. Suppose there were three ideas I really wanted you to get. I might make those ideas three separate learning goals, but maybe one of those things would happen a couple times and maybe one of the others would happen a couple times, whatever. But I do have to set, so when I'm writing stuff now, I'm actually, so what do I have? Like, I'm writing grade 3 right now. So I have 23 topics. Don't worry about all this. And most of my topics have about 3 lessons, not all of them. So essentially, I'm having about 60-ish learning goals, which are details. Like, do I need absolutely every one of those learning goals? The answer is no. I have fewer essential understandings. But I'm trying to give my lesson focus. So this is, to me, a big thing. I find a lot of lessons too unfocused for me. So unfocused means if you said to kids, like, what did you learn today, and they couldn't answer you, that's unfocused for me. So I want kids to be able not to say we did multiplication. I want them to be able to say, like, I learned this today. So this is a Marian thing. I feel the need for more focus. So I make more learning goals than I think you have to have, but that's because I think a lesson comes off better if it's focused. That's like a belief. So I have more learning goals than I absolutely have to have, but I like having them because it gives like this lesson a different flavor than this lesson, so that kids see facets of things, but they're focused one at a time. That doesn't make me right, it's just what I'm doing. My essential understandings are way smaller. Like, there's a bunch, they keep coming over and over. And that's just like me in 2016 and like where my head is now. And I didn't do this like all the time. I did the same like sort of stuff all the time, but my little details have changed. And your details change. Like, I'm no different than you. Your details change because you have experiences, and those experiences like talk to you. And you say, you know, that wasn't so good, so maybe I'll try this way. So I'm just like on a learning curve like everybody else. And like right now, I think that part of the problem in math is kids don't know what they're learning. And so I've gotten like super focused on, you could actually tell me today, like, this is what we learned. And I'm focused on those learnings are ideas, not skills. So I don't want them to say I learned two-digit numbers. Like, that makes me sad. And do you understand that if your learning goal is two-digit numbers, you can't differentiate? Ain't happening, because you can't. Because you already said, like, two-digit numbers. Like, there is no place to go. Or not much place to go. So because I believe that different kids have different needs, I need this sort of broader learning goal that talks to everybody, that allows me to have some differentiation going on, but is like an important learning goal. So that's what this is all about. Here's a different learning goal. I can figure out whether it's possible to represent a problem with a multiplication sentence, and I can write that sentence if it is. So I look at a problem and I can tell you, yep, that's multiplication. And he can tell you what to write. Or I could say, nope, that's not multiplication. So you could say it a lot of different ways. You could say, like, I can recognize multiplication. Like, you can use whatever lingo you want. But do you get that actually recognizing what is a multiplication situation, I'm going to say this out loud, is more important than being able to multiply? Because your calculator can multiply, but it can't recognize. It can't. You're the it for the recognizing. So I'm saying, if I'm making learning choices about where to spend my energy, different people have different beliefs. So the people who hate me and visibly say that a lot will say that, you know, like, they think that the focus should be on the doing the multiplying. I'm saying, like, we have calculators, guys. So I actually am very focused on estimation and mental math. But like, do I, like, if you ask me seriously, do I care if any one of a kid could multiply 23 by 45 with the standard algorithm? My answer is that's stupid in 2016. Do I want every kid in front of me to know that 23 times 45 is 800-ish? The answer is absolutely yes. Like, absolutely yes. Those are two like super different things. Do I want a kid to know, hey, this is a time you multiply? That's huge. So that usually gets like short shrift, and you spend like all this time like getting good at it, but it's a good that we don't need anymore. Like, we need other goods. So to me, this becomes a learning goal. Could be a test. So providing a number of situations and asking whether it is or not a multiplication. If it's not, change it so it is. So here's an example. Andy had three times as much money as Alice. Alice had $3. How much did Andy have? Is that a multiplication? Yes or no? I hope you're saying yes. And like, what would you multiply? Well, there's not too many things to choose. There's a three and a three, so that's what I'm talking about. It's all good, nice and easy. All right, here's another one. Andy had $3 more than Alice. Alice had $4. How much did Andy have? It's not a multiplication. So I'll say to my kids, they both had two numbers, so like, what's different here? And you make them talk about it. And then I threw in this one because I have content knowledge. Here you go. Andy had $3 more than Alice. Alice had $3. How much did Andy have? Is like sort of multiplying and sort of not. Do you get that it's just like the middle one? The only thing I changed was $4 to $3. But that happened to change everything. Because now you could multiply. Are you okay with that? So that's where content knowledge comes in. Like, I'm smart enough to know to ask that question and that question. Are you okay with that? It's not critical, but it like, it's good. So I'm going to ask them that. And then if it's not a multiplication question, like the middle one, I'm going to say, well, what would you do to change it for one before they sell that last one? And see what they come up with. Like, I want to hear if they know what's going on. Then I have consolidation questions like, how could you tell when something was a multiplication? Like, what were your signals, guys? What was it? If I hear the word times as a signal, I'm saying not good enough for me. You okay with that? That is a signal, but, you know, like, it could be the times are 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock. You know, so that's not the best signal. So what are better signals? Could some of the problems be solved by more than one operation? I'm hoping they say yes, because it's pretty much often yes. How does this picture show both 3 and 15? 3 what's, 15 what's? So do you get this in my unit change? There are three groups, but there's 15 thingies. Okay, so I'm gonna have kids talk about that. Does every multiplication picture for 3 times 5 show both 3 of something and 15 of something? Like, what do you think? So I just want them to like think about these things. All right, we're getting super late, so blah, 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 blah. Okay, so I'll do lots of blah, blah, blahs. I've been starting with big ideas. You can start with an expectation and work toward what big idea would this go toward. So there'll be some you can look at later to show you that. So here is an expectation, which is like skillish. Multiply this away, whatever. And so I'm going to say the bigger thing for me is composing and decomposing numbers is a useful way to perform operations with all big numbers. That's where I'm going for. So when you multiply 2 2-digit numbers, you make them pieces and you do pieces. Everything with big numbers, honestly, is about pieces. Everything. So I won't kiss into that. Yeah.
It's okay. Can we link that first one to the other idea that we were talking about representing numbers in different ways?
Yes.
So that's where we're going with representing numbers in different ways.
Yes, it's one of the places to go, yeah. Blah, 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 blah. You can read all this later, blah, blah, blah. What story would you ever use 34 times 182 to tell? It's a different way. I know I'm just, you're going to look at all this later. Oh my God. Okay. So, I'm going to say, cause we have 5 minutes. Math is about patterns and relationships. So it is my belief that when kids do isolated problems, they don't see connections, patterns, and relationships. And to me, that's what math is. So I think that puts them at a disadvantage. So that's why I believe lesson goals derived from bigger ideas is the way to go, because connections are more automatically happening. Don't worry, I'm going to give you all this. Okay. Blah, 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 blah. I think we've talked about most of these. What I think is less valuable, I already told you, is going through a first do this and then do this and then do this, because whatever list I have is only right for some period. Like, period. There's no perfect list for everybody. Monitoring, asthma is into monitoring. So there I said, if you believe as I do that it's the big picture, the connections that matter most, there need to be ways to look at lesson consolidations and assessment to see if that's the messaging that teachers are giving kids. Like, if I look at a consolidation, is the focus on how did you get the answer? Or is the focus on like looking for connections and relationships? And you can see that. When you look at assessments, you can see like what is the teacher focused on? So this is what you're looking for if you buy into all this. You don't have to buy into this. This is just me. Okay, so I swear to you, once I get to the airport and I'm on internet, I will post this. So this is where it'll be, my website, One to Infinity. It'll say Sudbury, July. I just think I forgot to do it last night, but I'll do it like sometime today. All right. So that was kind of a little quick at the end there. But the message is the same. It's just more details, and maybe you guys can play with it later or not. You're welcome to email me anyway and ask me questions. I'm pretty good with my emails to respond, and it doesn't have to be anything formal. It's just like I'm wondering about, and I'm good with that. I obviously, and one of the things I'm going to say to you is when I speak, I have very strong beliefs. Like, I don't hide them much. but I keep saying, if you're hearing me, that those are mine. Like, I'm not saying that I got the answers for the universe. I'm saying I've had 40 years of experience, and I'm sort of good at what I do, and this is where I'm at now based on my experiences. So it doesn't make me right, but it also doesn't make me a novice either. So they're not just like random thoughts. These are based on lots of experiences of what it seems to me people seem to have and not have. So I think that's how you have to look at anybody who speaks to you. Like, this is a perspective that any person has based on their experiences and where they're at now. And there is no person, including me, who has like the answers. But the reason we have directions is based on our experiences. And I've just been privileged to work with like a large group of people from a lot of places. And it seems to me these are the consistent themes that I'm seeing like wherever I go, whether it's Asia or Alberta or Ontario. So I don't think we're different in that sense. I just think that what's different is how we actually actualize it given the circumstances in which we're in. So I'm just going to end with, I think, macro's the answer. Yeah.
Marian, can I throw one question
sure.
at you?
Absolutely.
We asked a question yesterday about why
we think as a region we might be struggling. We came up with lots of ideas and we don't have the answer. If you were going to take a stab at not necessarily answering that question, but guiding us to think about what we may need to do on a regional or...
Yeah. So some of it, I'm not sure you can deal with, but so Chris and I talked about this last night. I lived in New Brunswick for 35 years. And I actually believe all my time in New Brunswick is very parallel to your life in this region. That essentially they are not cosmopolitan, they're rural area kind of mentalities. I know it's not all rural, but that's what it's like. So I lived in Fredericton, I could have been in Sudbury, like to me it's no different. Having lived there all those years and interacted with people there all those years, one of the things that I repeatedly heard was, yeah, kids, like some kids just can't, like some kids just can't. Like, and you're all okay with that because like that's the culture. So if you're living in, I live in Ottawa, if you're living in the Glebe, that's not the culture. It's like she is and he is and whatever. And like there is this much more, I'm gonna call it competitive life. Higher expectations, a demand for higher. I think one of the difficulties you have, and this is something you can't control, is that you live in a different kind of environment with different kinds of communities where you can live with your kid, like not doing great, and you don't like fall apart about it. And so that's a part that you can't control, like that's just the life. And my experience is, it was really interesting. I was in New Brunswick and they hired, I mean, New Brunswick always scores really, really low on everything. So they hired somebody from Alberta, like to come out and like tell us what's wrong. So I met with this person several times and she said exactly what all of us know. And she said exactly what I said. So here, like there aren't high expectations, like period. And if there aren't high expectations, you don't get high results. Like that's just like how it is. So essentially you have to recognize that you might be, and I could be wrong about your community, but I know it about New Brunswick because I talked to a million people. You live in a community where that isn't like the driving force. And if that's not the driving force, like you have to be the driving force. And so essentially you're the only people. It might not be the parents who are pushing this. It's like more on you, I'm gonna say, to push that, not to be competitive in like a bad way. It's just like, I think you can do this. Like, I think you could be great. Like, we got to go there because they don't all get that at home. They just don't. So I could be wrong about that stuff. I know it was true in New Brunswick. I lived in Fredericton, which is a little middle-class pocket. And it was kind of like different there than in communities like, you know, 25 minutes away. So I think it just makes your job harder. And it explains some of why it is. So on national tests, this is never gonna change. New Brunswick and PEI and whatever are always gonna be at the bottom part. Like it's never gonna change. Like I've accepted that like a long time ago because you're fighting a culture kind of thing, but you still can make it way better than it was. And that's what we're in it for, is like to make it better than it was. So I think that, you know, you're not gonna compete with Forest Hill like ever in Toronto, but you are going to be able to raise the bar. And I think the raising of the bar is believing that we can do it and that we have to do it and that we want to do it. And it's like kind of cool to do it. So I think you have to help parents think, you know, like don't think your kid can't do it. Like I think she can and work on it. And I just think it's just, you don't want that in your face mother either. So in a way it's like great to be in this, you know, in that situation. But you do, I think you're fighting against that a little bit. Like that, I could be wrong, but that's sort of my belief. And this is the same person, the person from Alberta Assessment actually said exactly the same thing. So this was her experience. And she was from Alberta who does do well. But the deal for me is like, so it's interesting. I do in-service across the country and I was in BC. I actually went to school in BC and people think I was like ridiculous to leave Vancouver. And Vancouver is gorgeous. But I couldn't live in Vancouver because they are as laid back as it comes and I'm not. So one of the things that I was doing an in-service in Victoria and there was a teacher in the in-service who had just moved there from Alberta and she whispered to me, she said, "Do you see the difference?" And I said, "Yeah." And what I find, like this is a fact, that when I'm in Alberta or when I'm in Ontario, there is push. And when I'm in other places, there is not. Like I see it like all the time. And Alberta and Ontario usually are on the top because there is push. So it's about expectations. And I think that, I think we have an opportunity in Ontario because we are in Ontario and there's a big network of people and lots of potential for collaboration. to, and it's just about making it a broader kind of thing that we have these high expectations. But I think in math, the difficulty is high doesn't mean like all of a sudden magically scores on EQAO are going to go higher. High is like, what is it that we're after anyway? And I think that's like the big part. So that's been my sort of mantra this morning. The big part is like, what are we after anyway? I don't know. Okay.
Somebody? Yes,
Marian, on behalf of our whole Northeast region, I'd really like to thank you for your time that you spent with us this morning, the provocations you provided us, the guidance and the advice as we embark on this MLN journey together. You've really pushed our thinking and problem solving, deconstructing expectations, enduring understandings, and developing learning goals based on ideas and thinking has really resonated with me. You've helped us focus on what matters the most for our deep work. And you've done it in a very genuine and humorous and fun way. So on behalf of all of us, thank you for being one of our critical friends on this learning journey. And we're very much looking forward to continuing our work with you.
Great, good.
Dessert and Mary.